स्टार्टिंग हेलो, वेलकम।
डॉक्टर सेमांत, कैन यू प्लीज इनवाइट डॉक्टर सिरगुरी आल्सो? डॉक्टर
हाँ सर,
सिरगुरी,
सर इज
डॉक्टर,
देयर? ओके, नहीं, आई हैव इनवाइटेड हिम। ओके सर,
ओके,
यस सर, आई हैव इनवाइटेड।
थैंक यू.
तो पीपल आर देयर, दे कैन ज्वाइन देमसेल्फ आल्सो, इवन इफ आई हैव केप्ट ऑल द पर्संस इन द डैशबोर्ड। सो दिस इज
I'll
वेरी
inform.
वार्म वेलकम to all the participants and the team UGC DACSR in the day 2 of National Awareness Workshop on UGC DACSR facilities. The day 1 was very wonderful. Please do join us on time, dear attendees, and the recording is available there in the YouTube, which we have been sharing to you through the email, and it will be updated daily with the lectures on that particular day. So for the day 2, to begin with, I invite Dr. Sudhindra for giving the report of the previous day. Dr. Sudhindra, please.
Thank you, Dr. Simalti, and very good morning to all of you. Yesterday we started our workshop with the neutron diffraction activities and some overview of the facilities available at the Mumbai Center and the projects and the work which is supported through Mumbai Center on the neutron beam activities, neutron beam research. So continuing in that in this workshop, today we will see the advanced facilities which are available for condensed matter research at Indore Center, and the facilities which are available at this Indus Synchrotron. So to start with, we will start with the overview of the facilities at Indore Center of the consortium, and I would like to invite Dr. Raghavendra Reddy to please give his lecture on the facilities. Over to you, Dr. Raghavendra. Dr. Reddy, you have to unmute yourself. We cannot hear you.
Can you see the screen now? Can you see the screen?
Dr. Samantha can't hear you.
Sir, we can see you, but we want to see your presentation. Please click on share and then share your screen. You haven't shared it so far.
I am clicking the share.
Yes, I think now I can see. Okay, now I'll be selecting. Hold on. So when you will be ready with your slide, then I will keep you live with the slide.
Is it all right?
No, I couldn't see your slide so far.
No, it is here. I mean, I am.
I am seeing your desktop. I am seeing your desktop, but not the slide.
I have opened it. I think there is slight delay. Perhaps we will just wait for some time.
No issue. No issue. We are waiting. Still, the lag is but natural, sir. No issue.
Microsoft Teams. Can you see now, sir? Not yet?
No, not yet. We are seeing your folder, this PC. You're having more than one screen?
Now you see the desktop with many files?
No, this is a lag. I think now the content is gone now. It is not shared now at this moment.
This is
it will come. Fine. There is a lag. Yes. We can see now. Hold on, sir. We can see it.
Yeah, great. We can see.
Just a minute. Yes, sir. Come to your slide one.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. I'm taking you live with the slides. So, dear attendees, dear participant, we hereby present you Raghavendra Reddy, sir, from UGC DHSR Indore Center. Yes, sir. Welcome, sir. You are live with your slides.
Yeah, morning, everybody. I'm sorry for the issues in the beginning. So before I start, let me thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to present the overview of the facilities that we have at our Indore Center of the Consortium. I am Raghavendra Reddy. Before going to the technical presentation, technical details of the presentation, I'll just briefly give you some details about our institute. In fact, this has been already discussed yesterday, for the students, for the participants, for the benefit of the participants who are not present during that time. So ours is basically an autonomous institution of the University Grants Commission. So we have four centers, in fact, three centers and one node. The basic idea, the basic mandate of our institute is to make the mega science facilities, Department of Atomic Energy, mega science facilities accessible to the university community. For example, we have a synchrotron radiation source at Indore, and then you have a neutron reactor at Mumbai, and then a cyclotron at Kolkata, and then again at Kalpakkam. So we have three centers and one node. Today I'm going to talk about the Indore Center facilities. And apart from this, the mandate making these mega science facilities accessible to the university community, over a period of time, in fact, we have developed a lot of state-of-the-art in-house advanced characterization facilities, which are used to the, which are accessible to the university researchers. And this is, in fact, a new concept in the university system of the country, that the new concept of researchers in the academic institutions working together. Just to show you how we progressed over a period of time. So this is about our three decades, like, for example, the number of students or the number of researchers who have visited our different centers for carrying out various experiments, towards their research work. So something like we have last year at our Indore Center, we had something like 200 participants coming from all over the country and doing the experiments. And this is the graph shows the number of universities or institutions that are participating in our research that are using our research facilities of various centers of the consortium. So other details, like all the details, you can always get from our website, www.csr.res.in. And now the question is, how do you make use of these facilities? In fact, this has been already discussed yesterday in a detail, but however, as I mentioned, just for the benefit of those who were not present yesterday, like this, one can make use of these facilities in basically in two modes, what we call it as a collaborative research scheme. And this collaborative research scheme can be two. One is a long-term project and one is a one single short measurements, like what we call it as a CRS 3 years project mode and CRS direct mode. And then the important thing is all these facilities are freely accessible to the university students. And then in fact, we provide local hospitality and travel support to the students or to the researchers whoever come to visit our facilities. At our Indore Center, we have recently started our user portal. So all the users, all the research proposals has to come through this user portal. One can visit this website for the details. It is in fact a very simple process. So there are seven steps. The moment you register yourself and then you log in and then you submit your experimental proposal what kind of experiments you would like to do at the center, and then that will immediately go to the concerned faculty member, and the concerned faculty member will assess it, will schedule the experiments, and in fact he can also talk to you regarding some more clarifications. This can be communicated between them, and then once the proposal is accepted, so one can visit the UGC DACSR and carry out the experiments, and then after the experiments we expect the researcher or the university student to submit this completion report, and then to submit this achievement experimental part, and then if there is any publication, register your publication, and then one can go through this cycle again. But however, because of this COVID-19 in the recent times, so this user activity at Indore Center is now limited. In fact, what we are doing is we are accepting the samples by post. So once you submit the proposal and the proposal has been accepted, and then you can send the samples by post to the concerned faculty member or to the user office, and then the experiments will be carried out by the concerned faculty members and the data will be shared to the researcher. But once this is COVID-19 situation will be over, probably so all the students can visit our centers for carrying out this experiments. So other details like the different facilities that we have, and then all the details are there in our website, this particular website. I request all the students to visit this site to make use of the facilities at our Indore Center. Now, coming to the technical part of the presentation, so this is how I classified the major research activities of Indore Center of the consortium. Basically, as I said, the basic mandate of our institute was to provide or facilitate the university community to make use of this mega science facilities of the Department of Atomic Energy, that is the synchrotron radiation source at Rajaramanna Center for Advanced Technology. One can also visit this website to get the other details about synchrotron, this radiation source at RRCAT. In fact, apart from this facilitating to the DAE facilities, in fact, we have our own two beam lines at the RRCAT. Our consortium has developed two beam lines. One is the photoelectron spectroscope beam line on Indus 1, and the other one is an XMCD beam line on Indus 2. So these details, perhaps Dr. Fase in the next talk will be discussing with you. And then, as I said, over a period of time, we have developed a lot of state-of-the-art in-house research facilities. I have categorized those facilities in three different categories. For example, we have facilities where one can look at the properties of the materials at very extreme conditions. Extreme conditions, what I mean is, like for example, temperature, the magnetic field, and then a moderate pressures. It is not an extreme pressures, but a moderate pressures, and of course an electric field. So we have a lot of facilities under this category. And then again, we have a very good groups. I mean, we have a strength in the area of study of the thin films, multilayers, and interfaces. And then we have different techniques where one can look at the structure of the samples, structure of the materials, and then we have different spectroscopic techniques to characterize these materials. And of course, we also have different microscopic techniques to study the materials. And apart from this, we have something like collaborative research schemes, what I have just mentioned. So these schemes can be of 3 years duration, or it can be a single direct mode. And we do conduct organized workshops and then summer training projects, something like this. For these details, all of you can look at our website for any updates. So now in the present talk, in the next few slides, what I'm going to talk about, or what I'm going to emphasize about, is only these three points, that is the different techniques, the different in-house experimental techniques that we have developed, that we have set up in our consortium to study the materials at extreme conditions, to study the thin films, and then to look at their structure, spectroscopic properties, and then microscopic properties. So these are the different details of major in-house facilities at our Indore Center of the consortium. So for example, we have various systems, various facilities to prepare the samples. We have recently started an activity in the area of the single crystal preparation. And then we have various high temperature furnaces for preparation of polycrystalline samples. For intermetallics, we have an arc melting system, and so on. And in the area of thin films, in fact, we have a variety of techniques which can be used to prepare the sample of your own choice. Like if it is an oxide sample, we have a pulse laser deposition. If it is a metallic sample, we have the sputtering techniques, and then electron beam evaporations. And then if it is a kind of polymers or so, we have a spin coating system. So therefore, in the area of the preparation of the samples, whether it is a single crystal, polycrystalline or thin films, we really have a very good experimental techniques available at our consortium. And coming to the characterization, for example, for the structural characterization, we have the X-ray diffraction, we have a thin film X-ray diffractometer, and then we have electron microscope, scanning electron microscope, transmission electron microscopes, and then scanning probe microscopes, and then magneto-optical Kerr microscopes to look at the structure and microscopy. And coming to the spectroscopy area, again, we have different spectrometers in our consortium. For example, we have a Raman spectrometer, and then we have a Mosbauer spectroscopy, which can be done at low temperatures and high magnetic fields. We have an X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. Again, we have a variety of X-ray photoelectron spectroscopies. For example, we have a lab-based systems, and then we do at the Indus synchrotron, which is known as the resonant photoelectron spectroscopy. And then we have an angle resolved, angle integrated, and inverse photo emission. We really have a very high level of expertise in these areas. And then we have a small angle soft X-ray absorption spectroscopy, and then X-ray magnetic circular dichroism, and then optical FTIR and near infrared spectroscopies. And whereas coming to this area where one can look at the properties of different materials at low temperatures and high magnetic fields, we really have a variety of techniques available in our consortium. We really have a very huge number of superconducting magnets. For example, I think we have something around 15 superconducting magnets, which are used to measure various transport properties, magnetisms, and then dielectric properties of all the materials at low temperatures and then high magnetic fields. I know probably this is a bit confusing slide, because if I show it like this, probably this will be confusing. The same thing, I show it in a different way. So in terms of the broad areas of the research that we are doing at our Indore Center of the consortium, I divided it into two parts. So these are the two areas in which most of my colleagues are working at Indore Center. One is the properties of materials at low temperatures and high magnetic fields. So in this category, we have various techniques, like looking from right from the structure. We do the X-ray diffraction at low temperatures and high magnetic fields, which is used to study the structural properties of the materials. And then we have variety of systems to look at the transport properties of the materials. And then we have systems where one can look at the dielectric response of the materials at low temperatures and high magnetic fields, and ferroelectric properties at such extreme conditions. And then we have variety of magnetic measurement techniques, like we have a vibrating sample magnetometer, we have a squid magnetometer, and then we have a scanning all probe microscopy, and we have a Mosbauer spectrometer, which essentially give the magnetic information of the sample at low temperatures and high magnetic fields. So these are the systems which are used to study the properties of the materials at low temperatures and as a function of the external magnetic fields. In addition to this, we have various low temperature facilities. For example, Raman spectroscopy, we can go down to liquid helium temperature. Similarly, these optical spectroscopic techniques, and then transmission electron microscopy, we can go down to liquid nitrogen temperature, and so on. Similarly, the second area in which we are very actively working in our Indore Center of the consortium is the area of the surfaces, thin films, and multilayers. So as I said, depending on your sample, depending on your requirement, we have various experimental techniques that are suitable to prepare the thin film of your sample. For example, if it is an oxide sample, we have a laser ablation system, and then we have variety of evaporation techniques like electron beam evaporation, sputtering, and then spin coating, etc. And at the same time, to characterize these prepared thin films, we also have variety of techniques, like for example, photoelectron spectroscopy, which essentially gives the surface information. And then we have low energy electron diffraction read, and then high resolution X-ray diffraction, conversion electron Mosbauer spectroscopy, Kerr microscopy, scanning probe microscopy, and then TEM, FESCM. So all these facilities are available at our website. So if you want to make use of these facilities for your research work, you can straight away contact the concerned scientist, or you can always write to our center director for any other details. And then, or you can just visit our user portal and then submit the research proposal. So I would say that, so these are the two broad areas in which, in fact, I would say without any hesitation that our center, in fact, it competes with the best labs in the world in these two areas. I am making this statement not because we have a variety of instruments with us. What I am making this statement because of faculty, the expertise faculty that I have, that we have in our indoor centers. So this is the list of the faculty. So most of them work in the area of the experimental condensed matter physics. So all these experimental facilities are in fact maintained by this faculty, supported by the technical and scientific staff. And then the backbone of our research activity, in my opinion, I would say that it is basically the in-house research students of the consortium. So at the moment, we have about 70 research students of the consortium who in fact maintain these experiments, and then they try to help the university students. They try to interact. In fact, we observe that most of the university students are very easily communicating, very freely they communicate with our university, with our in-house students, and they carry out their experiments. So for me, in this particular 1 hour, it is really impossible to talk about all these experimental facilities. In fact, so we have different experts working in these areas. So rather what I would do is, I'll very quickly go through all the facilities, all these facilities one by one, and I will give the technical details of each instrument and the corresponding scientist email address. So in the same transparency, so if whoever is interested to make use of this experimental technique, so can note down this email ID and contact with the concerned scientist. And I will try to show some of the representative examples from each one of these experiments. I'll try my level best to convince you what kind of information that one can get and how one can plan their experiments. And if time permits, I will try to explain these experiments in detail, like the Mosvar spectroscopy and then magneto-optical Kerr effect and then thin film X-ray diffraction. Now, as said, our consortium has an expertise in probing the properties of the materials, like whether it is structure, magnetic, transport, dielectric, spectroscopy, whatever it is, at low temperatures and high magnetic fields. And so the backbone of this activity is our cryogenics lab. So in fact, we have a very good cryogenics lab in our consortium. So these are the different plants, different cryogenic plants that we have in our consortium. We have a liquid nitrogen system which can give about 40 liters per hour. And then we have two liquid helium plants, helium systems. So this one is an old one. This has a capacity of 20 liters per hour with pre-cooling. And then this one is a very recently installed, a higher capacity system, higher capacity liquid helium production system from the Linde. And then this has a capacity of something like about 90 liters per hour with liquid nitrogen cooling. So the backbone of our activity, that is the exploration of the materials at low temperatures and high magnetic fields, which I am going to show in the next coming few slides, is because of the cryogens that we produce in our cryogenics lab. So most of the superconducting magnets in our consortium, or I would say all the superconducting magnets in our consortium, are with the liquid helium only. The first system that I would like to show you is this one. So this is the system which is used to do the X-ray diffraction measurements at low temperatures and high magnetic fields. Dr. N.P. Lalla is the concerned scientist. You can contact him directly about any other details of the system. This is a superconducting magnet purchased from the Oxford, and we have purchased the Oxford superconducting magnet, and then we have developed the entire system. Like, for example, this is the rotating anode generator, and this is a Goebel mirror. All this beamline has been constructed, and then these motors and everything has been done in-house. And then this is the, using this system, one can look at the X-ray diffraction at low temperatures down to 4.2 Kelvin and as a function of the 8 Tesla magnetic field. So for example, this is one such representative data. In fact, other details you can get from this this paper, Review of Scientific Instruments, published in 2016. So one can look at the materials which show the phase transitions as a function of temperature and as a function of the magnetic field. So if you want to look at the structural transitions that are taking place in your sample as a function of temperatures and magnetic fields, this is the best system. And in fact, I would say that, so these kind of systems are very rare. I think these are the this is one of the few systems across the world where people do the diffraction at low temperatures and high magnetic fields, X-ray diffraction at low temperatures and high magnetic fields. So this is the representative data I would like to show here. The sample was manganate, if I'm correct. So this is the X-ray diffraction measured at zero field conditions at 4.2 Kelvin and then at different magnetic fields. And then, so this has a difference, say, for example, ferromagnetic and then antiferromagnetic. This is something like phase coexistence. So these are the samples which exhibit the phase coexistence phenomena. And then one can really look at the structural counterpart of these magnetic systems in by doing this low temperature and high magnetic field X-ray diffraction. The other system that is effectively very extensively used by the university community of the country is this magnetotransport and calorimetry lab system. It is in fact one of the first cryostat of our consortium. This is an 8 Tesla magnet. Again, this was commercially purchased, but our faculty has worked on it to make, say, for example, using this system, we can measure the 16 samples at a time. One can look at the resistivity and the magnetoresistance of 16 samples at a time. So this is the development, this is the value addition that we have done to these kind of commercial systems. And using this system, one can also look at the heat capacity measurements. Like, these are some of the details about the samples that you are planning. And then this system also, there is a possibility that one can do this transport properties like resistance, magnetoresistivity as a function of the external pressure. So the pressure that can be applied is of the order of only 25 kilobar, and these are some of the details. And then how the transition temperature is changing in these iron rhodium samples which exhibit this first order phase transition with the applied pressure are shown here. And then this is some data about the temperature versus resistance. This system, as I said, is being extensively used by the university community. So the magnetic field that can be applied here is 8 Tesla, and with the helium pumping, it can go up to 10 Tesla. And we have a couple of more systems in our consortium where one can do the magnetoresistance and resistance measurements down to with very high fields. For example, initially it was 8 Tesla. Now we can do the measurements at 16 Tesla down to 2 Kelvin. So this is a recently installed cryostat in our consortium. This is a 2 Kelvin 16 Tesla PPMS system. Dr. Devender Kumar is the concerned faculty, and these are some of the details about the sample requirement. And similarly, we have another system where one can go down to, instead of 2 Kelvin, here one can go down to 300 Kelvin system, and then one can apply a magnetic field of 14 Tesla. This is again a system, this system has been purchased with the funding from the Department of Science and Technology under the low temperature high magnetic field project. So this, I would say that, so procurement of this project, because of this project, there was a quantum jump in our low temperature and high magnetic field activity in the consortium. So this is 14 Tesla and this is 16 Tesla. The minimum temperature that one can go here is about 300 millikelvin. And then we always want to go to the extreme conditions. So we have a recent system in which one can go down to temperatures, say something like 50 millikelvin, and the field is again 16 millitesla. So therefore, at the consortium, if you want to plan your experiments, the maximum field that we can apply is about 16 Tesla magnetic field, and the temperature that we can go down at the moment is 50 millikelvin. So this is again the resistivity heat capacity data of a sample, europium platinum silicon sample, which are known to exhibit what is known as a skirmionic phase. And one can look at these kind of skirmionic phase at such a low temperatures down to 50-100 millikelvin as a function of magnetic field of the order of 16 Tesla by measuring the transport properties at those extreme conditions. Sorry, I think there is some, okay. Apart from this conventional resistivity, we also have a system where we can measure the transversal component of the resistance as a function of the applied magnetic field, that is the Hall effect measurement system. So this system, one can do the measurements up to 9 Tesla and then down to 2 Kelvin. Dr. Archana Lakhani is the concerned scientist here. I think there is overlap of the graphs. I'm sorry for this. So this, using this system, one can look at the Hall resistance, anomalous Hall resistance, and then these are some of the single crystal data that they are, this group is very actively involved in the area of topological insulators. Of course, I'm not very expert in this area, but these kind of oscillations in the transport measurements, they essentially tells about the quality of the single crystals and then so on. We have another system in which one can do the dielectric measurements, dielectric constant measurements of the samples down to 5 Kelvin and a magnetic field of 9 Tesla. So this is one such representative data where we have shown the dielectric constant as a function of the temperature of a sample. This is a magnetodielectric or magnetoelectric sample, and one can clearly see the change in the dielectric constant across a magnetic transition, which is known as the spin reorientation transition. So across this spin reorientation transition, so there was a huge anomaly in the dielectric constant, and which was explained because of the magnetoelectric coupling in the sample. And then, so the data shows the magnetoelectric coupling by measuring the dielectric constant at 0 Tesla and then at magnetic field of 6 Tesla. In this group, apart from these dielectric constants, there is also a possibility of measuring higher order electrical susceptibility, like they measured this electrical dielectric susceptibility, nonlinear dielectric susceptibility, and also they have a system differential scanning calorimeter and then a thermal conductivity measurements in this particular group. So where this is again extensively used by the many researchers who are working, say, for example, in the area of glasses and so on. So once we measure the dielectric constant, in fact, we also have a system where one can look at this ferroelectric properties of such dielectric materials. So this is again a commercial system. And then we have developed our own sample holders where we can do the measurements at low temperatures and a small amount of magnetic fields. You see, it may be interesting to note that measuring the ferroelectric loop of a sample is not straightforward as that of measuring MH loop, magnetization loop of a sample, because the electric field, application of the electric field is always risky because it depends on the capacity of your sample. If the sample is a leaky sample, it can always break down and then it will cause a lot of problems. So this data, I'm showing it here. This is a barium titanate ferroelectric material doped with tin, about 30% tin doped in the barium titanate ferroelectric material. And that turns out to be a relaxer. And then this is a temperature dependent ferroelectric data. I'm showing it here. So we can go down to very comfortably about 100 Kelvin. And if the sample is really demands the low temperature, we can also go down to helium temperatures. But as I said, at such low temperatures, the amount of the electric field that can be applied is limited at the moment in our system. So this is the data of a bulk sample, a polycrystalline powder sample. And then we also have a possibility of measuring ferroelectric properties of thin films, the ferroelectric properties of thin films at low temperatures down to helium again. And the magnetic field here is not very high. We have the magnetic field of about only 3 Tesla. And what I'm showing here is the ferroelectric loops of a thin film. It's very interesting to see these kind of loops. I mean, it is very difficult to get the ferroelectric loops of a polycrystalline thin film because of a lot of problems in the leakage and so on. So here we could prepare a very high quality ferroelectric thin film using the spin coating. This is a 4-layer Arrhenius compound. And then we have made our own contacts. Like, you need to have a bottom electrode and then you need to have a top electrode. And by making use of this capacitor, one can measure the ferroelectricity down to lowest temperature of 4.2K. And even at lowest temperature, we could also apply a magnetic field of the order of 3 Tesla. So here we went up to 2.5 Tesla. And then since it was showing very weak magnetoelectric coupling, but the point in showing it here is we have a possibility of measuring the ferroelectric and then dielectric properties of the samples, whether it is polycrystalline or thin films, at low temperatures and high magnetic fields in our consortium. Whereas coming to the magnetic measurements, I would say that in our consortium, Indoor Center of the consortium, we have different techniques, in fact, to cover different length and time scales. Say, for example, we have various two vibrating sample magnetometers, two split magnetometers, where the magnetic signal comes from the bulk of the sample. So these are the samples, these are the experimental techniques where the signal is coming from the entire bulk of the samples. So this, I would say, these are macroscopic kind of measurements. And then we have other techniques like magneto-optical Kerr effect, where the signal is coming only from the surface of the sample, only from few nanometers of the surface of the sample. And then we have a magnetic force microscopy, that is scanning probe microscopy, where the signal can be, one can get the signal from few microns. So therefore, I would categorize them in terms of the mesoscopic measurements. And then on the other hand, we have two such techniques where the information is really localized. Say, for example, microscopic information that one can get, say, for example, Mas-Bohr spectroscopy, it gives the information from the nuclear level point, from the nucleus itself. So So this is a very localized techniques, and then we have another technique which is very, very powerful at Indus 2, which is element specific magnetic measurements, that is the X-ray magnetic circular dichroism. So these are the techniques which in fact cover different length scales of your measurements, like starting from the macroscopic measurements to that of the microscopic length scales. And whereas coming to the time scales, when I talk about the time scales, say for example, Mosbauer spectroscopy gives the information within this Larmor precision time. That means you can say, for example, of the order of few 10⁻⁵, a few nanoseconds or so. Similarly, by doing the AC susceptibility measurements and by changing the probe frequency, the frequency of your excitation, one can look at the different dynamics. And at the same time, say for example, magneto-optical Kerr effect is one such technique, in fact, which covers the entire time frame of the magnetization response of the sample. So therefore, so this is very unique of our consortium, that we have such a huge number of facilities, or rather very relevant facilities, to cover different length and time scales of your samples. So this, we have two vibrating sample magnetometers at the moment, 14 Tesla and then 16 Tesla. And we can go down to 2 Kelvin, and the maximum temperature we can cover is 350 Kelvin. And in fact, our journey started from in-house built magnetometers. So this was one of the first magnetometer that was in-house built, down to nitrogen temperature. And this is another system which was built down to 4 Kelvin. And this is the 14 Tesla. As I said, this was the same system. It is one of the system that we procured in DST, low temperature, high magnetic field project system. And then in addition to this, now we have another 16 Tesla and then a 7 Tesla squid system. And one of the noteworthy contribution of our consortium in the area of the magnetism is by what is known as looking at this disorder, looking at these first order phase transition materials. And then we have a protocol, something called cooling and heating in unequal fields, which is popularly known as CHEP protocol. And this protocol has come from our consortium. And this is essentially used to study what is known as phase coexistence materials. So the basic idea in this phase coexistence material is one can tune these phases, different phases. Say, for example, what I show here is an example from a shape memory alloy. But in fact, so these kind of measurements or this phenomena has been studied in variety of materials, not only in shape memory, like manganites and then multiferroic shape memory alloys, and then a variety of systems. This has been studied extensively, this CHEP protocol, and then tuning the phase fractions with the magnetic field. So essentially making use of this magnetic field as a other thermodynamic parameter to tune the different phases that are present in a sample. And then apart from this vibrating sample magnetometers, for the thin film magnetic measurements, we have a squid vibrating sample magnetometer. So the basic advantage here is the sensitivity of the sample, the sensitivity of the measurements. Look at this graph. The sensitivity here, the magnetization is in terms of the micro EMUs. The signal is very, very weak. The sensitivity comes from the squid part. And then the fastness in the measurements, say for example, this is the data that is shown here, MH data, where this entire data, we could record it something like 1.5 hours. The fastness in the measurements comes from the VSM option. So this squid plus VSM, both options in the squid vibrating sample magnetometer is basically effectively used to study the samples where the movement is very, very small, say for example, thin films. And apart from this, this group also has done some attachment, some development where one can measure the magnetization, magnetic signal of the samples with the application of the external magnetic fields. So very moderate external magnetic fields one can apply. So this was a manganite sample deposited on a barium titanate substrate. So this is squid VSM that we have in our consortium. And then we have what is known as a scanning Hall probe microscopy. So this basically is basically in a magnetic force microscopic system. So what essentially one can look at is, one can look at the surface of the sample and one can look at the magnetic response. One can map the magnetic phases that are present in your sample. So for example, what is shown here is, if you look at this color bar, so this color represents the antiferromagnetic phase and this color represents a ferrimagnetic phase in this particular sample. And one can visualize the magnetization, the magnetic sample by measuring this these measurements at low temperatures, say for example again down to 5 Kelvin, and the magnetic field that can be applied is 9 Tesla. So this is the last magnetic measurements I will be talking about. So we have a very interesting system in our consortium, that is the Mosbauer spectrometer, and this Mosbauer measurements we can also do at low temperatures and high magnetic fields. I would say that this low temperature high magnetic field Mosbauer system is in very unique facility in the country, and this has been used extensively to study various issues, say for example spin canting in magnetic nanoparticles, cation distribution, transport of hyperfine field, critical exponents, magnetic texture, phase coexistence, and so on and so forth in variety of samples. Probably time permits, I will talk about these things at the end of my presentation, but just since I just wanted to show you, so we have a very we had a very good collaboration with one of the groups from Uttarakhand, Pantnagar University, where they have used our Mosbauer spectrometer, and then they could publish some papers. And then this data I wanted to show you, so most of the university people are very actively working in the area of ferrites, which are very technologically important. In fact, yesterday you have seen the neutron diffraction study of these ferrites also. And probably, if time permits, I will talk about this at the end of my presentation. So these are all the facilities that whatever I have shown are the systems with the at the low temperatures and then with high magnetic fields. And then we also have, as I said, the systems where we can do the measurements with the function as a function of temperature down to the liquid helium. And then this is Micro Raman is one system which is in fact extensively used by the university research groups. So this has been used to study various materials by different universities of the country, and these are some of the specifications here. Dr. Vasant Sate is the faculty. One can do the measurements down to liquid nitrogen, and one can also do the measurements down to liquid helium. And even in fact, we have gone below the liquid helium temperature by pumping the liquid helium, and then high temperature is about 600 Kelvin. Since the strength of this technique is Micro Raman's technique is basically it is a localized technique. One can say, for example, so in this particular GDFeO3 sample, so there was a point, there was a confusion, and then we know that there is a transition from a high symmetry state to the low symmetry state as a function of temperature below the 4 Kelvin temperatures. And X-ray diffraction, since it measures the entire sample, it averages out over the entire sample, we could not get information about the such local symmetric reduction. But whereas by measuring the Raman spectrum at such low temperatures, say for example, if you can see, so there is a clear cut development of a Raman mode at low temperatures when you go down below the liquid helium temperature. So this indicates the reduction in the symmetry of the sample as you go down to such as you go down the temperature. So these kind of measurements one can do with our Raman spectrometer. And then we also have a very active group working in the area of thermoelectric materials. Dr. Okram is the faculty here. He works a lot of in thermoelectric materials, and this he can do the measurements from 5 Kelvin to 330 Kelvin. And then in fact, he has done a lot of interesting work in various materials and then publishing very high impact factor, high impact making publications. And then we have optical spectroscopic techniques with different attachments, like we can go down to low temperature, liquid nitrogen temperatures, and then say for example, high temperature attachments. All these things, if you are interested, you are requested to contact the concerned scientist, Dr. Deshpande. And then we have another faculty working in the area of, say for example, again, thermoelectric power measurements and then resistivity measurements. So these are some of the experimental facilities that are available. You can contact him, Dr. Dinesh Shukla. Now, so these are the techniques that have come under the category of materials at low temperatures and high magnetic fields. Now I will go to the second part of the presentation, that is the thin film preparation and characterization. So as I said, we have different techniques in our consortium to make the thin films of various materials depending on your sample. Say like, for example, if it is oxide sample, we have a pulse laser deposition, and then if it is a metallic kind of samples, and then if you are interested to make use of electron beam evaporation, sputtering. So these are the different techniques that are available. But these are systems that have been effectively, extensively used by various research groups of the country. One is the pulse laser deposition system, and the other one is the sputtering system that we have in our consortium. So in the case of this, I'll talk about these systems in the next coming slides. So coming to the pulse laser deposition system, so the basic principle is basically you have a very high energetic pulse laser hitting the target, and then you have a substrate at high temperature, and then this laser ablates the material from your target, and then it deposits on the sample in terms of a very simple logic, if I say it in very simple words, if I explain. But the advantage of this technique is, and this is one of the best techniques, to preserve the stoichiometry of the sample. So whatever the stoichiometry that you have in your target material, the entire stoichiometry will be transferred from the target to that of your substrate. So it is one of the best techniques to prepare oxide samples. And this group has done a lot of work in various oxide materials, for example, starting from all the manganites, ferroelectrics, and then whatnot, almost all the oxide materials, superconductors and so on. So they have been prepared by making use of the pulse laser deposition of the consortium. And now this pulse laser deposition is also equipped with read facility to monitor the real-time growth. That means during the deposition of the samples, as a function of time, how your sample is growing, one can look at by measuring the read intensity patterns. And this is nothing but molecular beam epitaxy. So this facility also we have at the moment in our consortium. And I'll just show one example here from one of the in-house results. Like this was the film, epitaxial thin film of LaVO3, lanthanum vanadate, deposited on LaVO substrate using this pulse laser deposition. And this is the X-ray data confirming the epitaxial nature. And by making use of this photoelectron spectroscopy, so this group has done extensive photoelectron spectroscopy, electronic structure on these kind of samples, and they try to study these kind of insulator, Mott-Hubbard insulators or charge transfer insulators. So the point that I wanted to convey here is we have a very good epitaxial, we have a very good system which can be used to prepare epitaxial thin films of any material, most probably, and any oxide materials, one can conveniently grow their epitaxial thin films in our consortium. And the second system that is again extensively used by the university community is the sputtering laboratory. And then here we have an anvil sputtering, and then we have a magnetron sputtering. And then what we have is something very interesting. This is high beam system, that is high power impulse magnetron system. So this kind of high power that comes in pulse, the power in terms of this impulse, power impulses are essentially used to grow the samples, where if you are interested, say for example, if you are interested to grow a dense films, so these kind of systems are very, very useful. So one can, in this group, one can do, say for example, co-sputtering, one can do the reactive sputtering, depending on your interest, depending on your target, depending on your sample, one can make use of this sputtering mechanism to grow high quality thin films. Again, this system is equipped with read recently, so therefore one can grow, one can monitor the lifetime, real-time growth of the thin films during the deposition. So this group is actively involved in studying. One of the area that is actively involved is the preparation of these nitrides, various transition metal nitrides like iron nitrate, cobalt nitrate, and so on. And then they measure the diffusion of these samples. And then they have a technique which is known as the secondary ion mass spectroscopy, which is essentially gives the elemental profile across the depth of the sample. By making use of this SIMS as a function of thermal annealing, and this thermal annealing, they have a very good system, what is known as ultra high vacuum rapid thermal annealing system, RTA system, which can be done at ultra high vacuum conditions. The interesting property of this system is one can achieve the ramp rates as high as something like 100 degrees centigrade per second. Very rapidly, one can anneal the sample depending on your sample, and one can go up to, say, for example, 1000 degrees centigrade, one can anneal the system at ultra high vacuum conditions. By making use of these complementary techniques, one can look at this diffusion mechanism in such nitride thin films. So in addition to these systems, we also have a very good system in our consortium where one can do various measurements. One can do various measurements like magnetic measurements. One can study the evolution of magnetism, transport, and then structural during the thin film preparation. Thin film growth, that is thin film preparation, which is known as in situ thin film deposition techniques. So we have a very good in situ thin film deposition system in our consortium, and Dr. Dilip Kumar is the faculty. So this is the schematic of the system, and this is how the actual system looks like. So here during the deposition of the thin film, right from the first layer of your sample, right from the few monolayers of your sample, one can do the read pattern, one can look at the structure, one can do the magneto-optical carrier, one can look at the magnetism, and then one can also do the magnetoresistance measurements, one can also do the structural properties. All these things one can do during the deposition of the thin film itself. So therefore, this has a lot of advantages, like you don't have to prepare n number of samples to look at the rest, to study, to characterize these thin films. Now, this magneto-optical Kerr effect, in fact, we have a very good magneto-optical Kerr effect in our consortium, where we can do the MS data at room temperature, and then we can also do the MOG during the preparation of the thin films, and then we can also do the microscopy of this. One can also image magnetic domains using these MOG techniques, and if time permits, I will take up this in the end of my talk. And then, regarding X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, probably the next speaker will talk about these systems in detail, but for the sake of continuity, so in fact, we have a very good electron spectrum. We have different groups working in the area of electron spectroscopy, photoelectron spectroscopy. So basically, this is a photon in, and then what you measure is the electrons that are coming out of the sample. So these are electrons which are charged particles. So you have a surface information. What you get is only a few angstroms of the sample. So this gives you the surface information. So we have a lab-based system in our consortium. Dr. Deshpande, Uday Deshpande is the faculty. And then we have an inverse photoemission and then angle resolved photoemission. Dr. Burman is the faculty. And then we do X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy with the synchrotron. Since it is with the synchrotron, so therefore we can tune the incident energy. And that is the resonant photoemission. Dr. Fase and Dr. Ram are the faculty members. Now, the microscopy methods. So we have a very good scanning probe microscopy group in our consortium. In fact, if I'm correct, so this is one of the first few atomic force microscopies of the country. And this has been, we have been doing, many users have extensively used this atomic force microscopy setup of the institute. And then our in-house group has also done some significant work, say, for example, in the area of biological samples like E. coli and so on. And then this is the MFM data, representative MFM data of some magnetic tape sample. And in addition to this AFM and MFM, we have very old, I mean, one of the old scanning electron microscope systems, which is used to study the morphology. And then at the same time, one can also do the IRAX measurements. So this scanning electron microscopy is now recently, we have procured one more system with a better specification. Say, for example, here the resolution is of the order of 3.5 nanometers. Now we can go down to say something like 1.4 or 1.8 nanometer resolution. And this scanning probe electron microscopy is now field emission equipped with the field emissions possibility. So this is the field emission scanning electron microscope. So here one can resolve very fine microstructure of the samples. Apart from this, doing the microstructure or the topological studies of the samples, using this FESM. This also, one can also, there is also a possibility of doing the lithography. So this is, system is now equipped with an electron beam lithography. And these are some of the patterns that have been developed using this system at our consortium. You can write to Dr. Fase or Dr. Venkatesh for any other technical details. We have a very good scanning tunneling microscope system in our consortium. And this STM measurements that can be done at ultra high vacuum conditions, at low temperatures as low as something like 25 Kelvin at liquid helium, and then at high temperatures of the order of 1000 Kelvin, one can do this SPM measurements, STM measurements down to right from the few monolayer sensitivity. And this is some example that I'm showing it here from this group. You can write to Dr. Burman for other details. So this is a surface reconstruction on gold 111 surface. Look at the resolution. You have an atomic resolution of the one can have the possibility of atomic resolution using these microscopic experimental techniques. We have a transmission electron microscope, and this is Dr. N. P. Lalla is the faculty here. And then there is a possibility of, say, for example, doing the cross-sectional transmission electron microscopy of these samples. And then, if I am correct, this is one of the very few transmission electron microscopes where the possibility of variation of the temperature is there. Most of the transmission electron microscopes, they only do nanoparticles and so on and so forth. But here, we have a possibility of looking at this, looking at the samples, looking at the materials, electron diffraction, down to the lowest temperature, something like liquid nitrogen temperature. And this is the data of a sample, manganate sample, on temperature, and one can clearly see how the structural evolution is taking place as a function of temperature. So all these possibilities are there at our consortium. So now I think with this, I'll finish the first part of the presentation, and maybe if the moderator or if the chairman presents, maybe I'd like to take the questions about this part, and then I will go to the second part where I will talk about these experiments in detail. Dr. Sudhindra?
Yeah, Dr. Reddy, there's one question regarding the presentation so far, which says that is there any instrument to study the electron hole transfer mechanism?
Electron?
Just
Is there any instrument to study? Actually, I have published it. Sir, is there any instrument to study the electron hole transfer mechanism in different heterojunction thin film layer? It's saying, Priya Lakshmi's question, I am repeating. Sir, is there an instrument to study the electron hole transfer mechanism in different heterojunction thin film layer?
Yeah, I think I have my colleague here, Dr. Ram. I mean, one can do these measurements using this resonant photo emission.
Band offset
measurements at Indus. Maybe you can write to Dr. Ramjani.
So one can measure at the interface the conduction band offset and the valence band offset, and just by looking at their relative values, one can get an idea of whether it is hole being transferred in heterojunction or the electron at the middle region.
Is it clear, Sudhindra, Dr. Sudhindra?
Yeah. We could hear Dr. Ram speaking, so it's fine. I think it answers her question.
Maybe
there are no more questions here at present, so we can proceed with the next part of your lecture.
How much? I mean, maybe another 15-20 minutes?
Yeah, it should be okay.
Maybe.
Yeah. Now, you see, now I'll very briefly talk about these experimental techniques. Probably this I can give more information on these things. And this is how I'm planning to present. So the MOSBAR spectroscopy, most of you probably might be knowing, this is basically a resonant phenomena. But when I talk about the resonance is at the level of nucleus. So for example, I have a radioactive source which is in the excited state, and this goes to the ground state, and this excess energy transfers, and then this gamma photon will be absorbed by the sample, and this is basically a resonant emission and absorption of gamma ray. And this is how the experimental technique looks like. I have a radioactive source which is being subjected to the Doppler velocity. I'll explain why it is required to look at the Doppler velocity. And then I have the sample, and then I have the detector. If you are interested, maybe you can visit this website for other details about the MOSBAR spectroscopy. And there are many elements or many isotopes where MOSBAR spectroscopy is possible. But however, the most popular are iron, and then tin, and then europium. At the consortium, we have iron radioactive source and then tin radioactive source available with us. You see, the applications, in terms of the applications, are what is the significance of this MOSBAR effect is basically using the MOSBAR spectroscopy, one can study what is known as hyperfine interactions. So the hyperfine interactions are basically the interactions between the nucleus and then the extranuclear environment. So the nucleus, we know it has a charge, it will be having an electric quadrupole moment if the spin quantum number is greater than 1/2, and then it will have a magnetic dipole moment if the spin quantum number is greater than 0. And then all these nuclear properties from where you are getting the radioactive transitions can interact with the extranuclear environment, that is the lattice, that is your its surroundings. Say, for example, charge can interact with electron density, and quadrupole movement can interact with electric field gradient, and then this magnetic dipole movement will interact with the magnetic field. And these interactions are known as what is known as hyperfine interactions. And the important thing is, because of these hyperfine interactions, there is a small change in the energy levels, nuclear energy levels, by the order of 10^8, 6^-8 electron volt. This is really very, very small change in the electronic energy levels. And this change is essentially coming because of this interactions as a result of, say, for example, charge of the nucleus, as a result of the electric quadrupole movement. And if you detect this small changes in the energy, and then what one can look at is, one can look at its nuclear environment, that is, one can get the information about the lattice of the sample. And this Mossbauer effect, or gamma ray, in fact, which is where we talk about the quality factor, Q factor, which is given by delta E by E, is of the order of 10 power minus 13. In principle, what it says is, one can resolve 1 electron volt in 10 to the power of 13 electron volt change by making use of the Mossbauer spectroscopy. And this hyperfine interactions are of the order of 10 power minus 8 electron volts. So therefore, this is the advantage of this technique, is one can look at these hyperfine structures very effectively, and therefore one can study the extranuclear environment comfortably using this technique. So you have a radioactive isotope, you have a nuclear transition here in the source, and then you have the sample. But since the source and the samples have different environments, so the hyperfine strengths, the hyperfine interactions will be different. So therefore, what you are always, your subject, you are expected to modulate the energy of the radiation. That is the reason you subject it to a Doppler velocity. And this is how typically the Mossbauer spectrum looks like. If both of them have a similar environment, or you expect a peak at zero velocity, and then so on and so forth. But what I will talk about very briefly today is about the magnetic information that one can get from this Mossbauer spectroscopy. So this G-Mann splitting, probably most of us know. So basically, if you have a G-Mann splitting mu dot h, what happens is each energy level will be split into 2i plus 1 level, equally non-degenerate sublevels. For example, the ground state will be split into 2, and the excited state will split into 4. So therefore, now instead of only one transition possible, so now you have a 6 possible transitions among these nuclear energy levels. So therefore, the Mossbauer spectrum looks something like this. So you have 6 transitions at 6 different energies, depending on this, the splitting of the energy levels. So this is called six-line pattern in Mossbauer spectroscopy. And then the important thing here is the intensity of these lines, the intensity of all these 6 lines, it depends on by an angle theta, which is the angle between the direction of iron magnetic movement and then the gamma ray. So this angle theta, depending on if it is a random orientation, I have 3:2:1. This is 1 times, 2 times, and 3 times. And if theta is equal to 90 or 0, so this being a sine square theta dependence here, so the line intensity of these 2 second and fifth lines will be drastically different in Mossbauer spectroscopy, depending on the magnetic texture. So this is what we effectively use by doing the measurements at low temperatures and high magnetic fields. So when you do the measurements, we have a superconducting cryostat in our consortium. And what I show here is basically the tail part of the magnet. So this is the superconducting coil, and one can do the measurements in this geometry. The field is always this direction. I can send the gamma rays here, or I can send the gamma rays here. So when I do the gamma rays in this direction, this is known as longitudinal transfer measurements, and where the angle is equal to 0. So if the angle is equal to 0, so this sine square theta will be 0. So therefore, I don't expect these 2 lines to come in the Mossbauer spectrum. So this is what we effectively use to study, take advantage to study various magnetic materials. Say, I'll give a very simple example of ferrimagnetic materials, because ferrites are mostly well studied, and then are effectively still many groups are actively involved, many university groups are actively involved in the country to look at the ferrites. So ferrites are basically, you have Av2O4. The basic idea is you have 2 sublattices. One sublattice characterized by one internal field, and the other sublattice characterized by another internal field. And the distribution of the cations, the iron or whatever the magnetic cations in these 2 sublattices, octahedral and tetrahedral sites, and then the linearity of the magnetic structure, that means whether these movements are linear or they are canted with respect to each other. And this is what determines the magnetism of these samples. And there is a lot of scope to tune the magnetic properties of these ferrites by exploiting, say, for example, you change the composition, the magnetism will be different. You change the preparation method, the magnetism will be different. And then you do, say, for example, post-treatment of the samples, the magnetic property will be different. The core, the basic idea here is, when I do all these things, essentially the cation distribution in these 2 tetrahedral and octahedral sites is changing, and as a result, so the magnetic properties of these ferrites are differently are changing. So therefore, one has to look at the current distribution at these sites, and also one has to look at whether the magnetic structure is linear or so and so forth to understand these materials. So that can be done easily with the effect of with the help of infield Mosbauer spectrometer. So here I'm showing one example. In fact, here I'm showing one example of nickel zinc ferrite. So when I do the nickel zinc ferrite in terms of the nano regime, so this is the bulk nickel zinc ferrite. So this is the data measured with pi tesla magnetic field, and the composition is same, but the size has been reduced. We have gone up to the nano regime, and then the same measurement has been done at pi tesla magnetic field. And now the difference one can clearly see. So this line is completely absent here, and similarly this line is completely absent, which is in fact call it as 2/5 line, where the angle, it comes because of the angular dependence, sine square theta dependence. So if this line is absent, that indicates that theta is equal to zero. That means both the moments are anti-parallel to each other, and that means nothing but it's a collinear magnetic kind of structure. If there is a finite intensity of these lines, I would clearly say that so this structure is not a collinear magnetic structure. Of course, this also depends on the magnetic anisotropy of the samples, but most of the ferrites being soft ferromagnets, soft ferrimagnets, so most of the times, just by measuring the Mosbauer spectrum with the magnetic field, one can clearly say whether the magnetic structure is a collinear or it is a canted spin structure. And then by measuring this intensity, one can also quantitatively measure the angle theta, that is, one can also measure the spin canting that is present in the sample. And as I said, this Mosbauer spectroscopy can resolve the different sublattices that are present in your sample. So this is one sample data, gallium iron oxide. So this is expected to consist of three different sublattices. And then by doing the measurements at different temperatures, and then, for example, everybody knows that if you have a ferromagnet, both the sublattices will have different temperature dependence. It is not necessary that both of them have the same different temperature. In the bulk magnetic measurements, what you measure is basically the resultant sublattice, resultant magnetization, which is coming because of the two sublattices. But whereas if we do the measurements like Mosbauer spectroscopy, which is a microscopic measurement technique, you are looking at the sublattice itself. So therefore, one can resolve these sublattices and then look at the temperature dependence of the magnetization. So this information is not possible with the conventional bulk magnetic measurements on the other hand. And these are some of the recent literature. I think some of them are missing. So for example, in this gadolinium iron oxide, we went down to 2 Kelvin, and then we applied up, we did the measurements as a function of magnetic field, and then we could study, we could show mechanism that is responsible for the multi-ferroic nature. And similarly, this was a brown millerite sample, and here again there were two sublattices, and then by detailed Mosbauer measurements, we could show that both of them have different debye temperatures, and then that was the main point in explaining the huge magnetodielectric constant of these materials. And this data is not from the iron Mosbauer spectroscopy, but rather from the tin Mosbauer spectroscopy. Here it is again a barium titanate ferroelectric material, and then we have replaced titanium by tin. So therefore, essentially by doing tin Mosbauer spectroscopy, what we are doing is we are essentially looking at the titanium side of the barium titanate samples. These are some slight representative data that I would like to show you. Coming to, say, for example, Mosbauer spectroscopy, you see this measurement can be done in two geometries. Like if you have a powder samples, you just allow the gamma rays to pass through the sample. This is known as the transmission geometry, which is mostly suited for the powder samples. So you see, the moment the gamma ray is absorbed by the nucleus, and nucleus goes to the excited state, and this de-excitation, it can come again in the form of the gamma ray, or it can emit one of the atomic electron, what is known as the conversion electron. And the only difference between the conversion electron is, since it is a charged particle, it will have a finite range. So therefore, if I detect the conversion electron instead of the gamma ray, so what I essentially do is I get the information from the surface of the sample. So therefore, Mosbauer can also be done in this, what is known as a backscattering geometry, which is known as the conversion electron Mosbauer spectroscopy. So the conversion electron Mosbauer spectroscopy, what I do is I measure not the gamma rays, but I detect the conversion electrons that are coming from the sample. Since these have a finite penetration depth, so the information that I get is only from the surface of the sample. So this has a surface sensitivity, and since it is electron, So the sample has to be part of the detector. So the sample has to be a part of the detector. So this generally we make use of a continuous gas flow proportional counter. And this conversion electron mass gas spectroscopy, as I said, it has a surface sensitivity. And in fact, one can also go down to few monolayers of surface sensitivity of these techniques. As a matter of fact, in fact, why do you go for a surface sensitivity techniques is basically, if you are working in the area of magnetic thin films, so most of the times the thin films are deposited on what is known as a substrate. And then if you measure the magnetism of these kind of samples from the bulk magnetic measurements, whether it is SWID or VSM and so on, so what essentially you get is you get the response from the entire sample. That means not only from the magnetic thin film, but from the substrate gives a huge background. So therefore, if you are working in the area of these kind of samples, it is always advantageous to have a surface sensitivity techniques. And there are some techniques which are which can give only the surface information. Say, for example, conversion mass gas spectroscopy, just I explained. And there is one more technique which is magneto optical correct. And then there is a very powerful technique, X-ray magnetic circular dichroism. Probably next speaker will talk about this. And I'll now go to this magneto optical Kerr effect, which is in fact a very simple technique, but the information that it uses is very, very interesting and then very useful in the area of the magnetic thin films. So the magneto optical Kerr effect is basically is very simple in terms of the definition. What happens is, if you have a plain polarized light, if you have a polarized light incident on a magnetic material, and because of the magneto-optic interaction, so the plane of polarization will be changed in the reflection. The change in the polarization in the reflection is Kerr rotation, and the same phenomena in the transmission is known as the Faraday rotation. So the angle by which this polarization is changing depends on the strength of the magneto-optic interaction. So now the magnetism of the sample is changing, so this angle by which it is rotating will change accordingly. So, and this is proportional to the magnetization of the sample. So in principle, experimentally, if I can measure this angular change as a function of the magnetization, which is nothing but as a function of the external magnetic field, essentially I will be able to measure the magnetic response of the sample. And since here I'm talking about the reflection geometry, and this is the incident laser, which has a certain penetration depth. So what I get is only a surface information. I get the information only from the surface of the sample. So therefore, this technique is very, very suitable and powerful for the thin films, magnetic thin films. So this is how one can explain why do you get this. I'll skip this one. So for example, experimentally, what essentially you do is, you have a S-polarized light and then falling on the sample and getting reflected from the sample. If it is a magnetic sample, there is a change in the polarization, and this polarization, as a result of this magneto-optic interaction, what we have is, you have a small amount of orthogonal component, that is P-polarized wave, that is developed in the sample. And experimentally, one has to detect this P component, that is orthogonal component, and then that one can easily do. Say, for example, this is the laser. You have a first polarizer and it is giving you the plane polarized light falling on the sample and getting reflected from the sample. And this second polarizer, I keep it at exactly 90 degrees, not exactly 90 by small amount of offset to the first polarizer. So whenever there is a change in the polarization, that component will be transmitted through the analyzer, and I measure this intensity as a function of the magnetic field. So the magnetic field is changing. The sample magnetization changes, the sample magnetization changes, the magneto-optic strength changes, and then the angle by which the polarization changes also will change. So by measuring this intensity as a function of the magnetic field, essentially what one can get is a magnetic hysteresis loop of the sample by using this magneto-optic carapet. And this has a very good three important advantages, this technique. The first possibility is, there is a possibility of doing the measurements in three geometries, longitudinal, transverse, and polar. So the result is, you do the measurements in three geometries, essentially you are sensitive to three components of the magnetization, like in-plane X component and in-plane Y component, and then out-of-plane component. And then this one can easily do by changing, say for example, the direction in which you apply the magnetic field or the direction in which your plane of incidence is happening. So one can also, so therefore, by using this simple technique, in principle, one can measure both in-plane magnetization, bicomponent F, that is the transversal component of the magnetization, and then perpendicular, that is polar component of the magnetization. The other possibility or the other advantage of this technique is, one can also do the measurements during the thin film preparation. So for example, since it is the laser which is talking to the sample, you see the laser is going into the chamber, one can easily focus the laser into the chamber. So the measurement is a non-contact method, because non-contact in the sense, what I mean is the laser which is talking to the sample. So therefore, one can always focus the laser from outside the deposition chamber. So as a result, one can do the Mohs measurements during the thin film preparation. So this is how, say, for example, on the substrate, when you grow 5 angstrom thin films, and one can easily look at how the magnetism is developed as a function of deposition time or film thickness by making use of the in situ Mohs measurements. And the third advantage of this technique is, in fact, there is a possibility since the magnetic hysteresis loop is nothing but is a response of the different alignments of the magnetic domains. So one can also look at these magnetic domains by making use of the magneto-optical Kerr microscope. That one can do this, say, for example, you have two anti-parallel domains, and then if you have two anti-parallel domains, so the total and then the change, the angle, the change of the polarization will be slightly different in both the cases. Therefore, if I put the second polarizer exactly blocking the signal from coming from the first domain, the second domain will appear as a bright, whereas this fellow will appear as a dark domain. So this is what is used in the literature. This is what is used in the literature to measure the magnetic domains. And at the same time, one can also do these measurements in real time at video frequencies. So therefore, by making use of this magneto-optic Kerr effect, one can essentially look at the microscopy, and then one can essentially look at the magnetometry. I don't think this video is working. The idea that I wanted to show here is, by measuring the magnetic hysteresis loop, one can easily at the same time simultaneously look at the evolution of the magnetic domains, which is otherwise not possible with most of the technique, or rather with any other techniques, where one can get both microscopic magnetic domains plus magnetic hysteresis loop from the surface of the sample. So these are some of the advantages of Kerr microscopy, or rather Kerr magneto-optical Kerr effect. So for example, the process of observation does not influence the magnetization. That means what I mean to say here is, it is basically a non-contact measurements. It is the laser which is talking to the sample from outside your chamber, and it is a non-destructive measurements. You have a possibility of magnetometry, and then the very important advantages with relevance to that of the thin films, it has a surface sensitivity. So that is the possibility of exploring the samples, thin film samples. So this is the technical, photo of the system that we have. If you want to make use of, say for example, you can have what I need is only the reflecting surface of the sample, and these are some of the technical specifications. And some examples, say for example, I wanted to show here is, this is the image data that we recorded from a 5 micron sample. So the sample here is of the order of only 5 micron. Just imagine, even from such a small sample, we could get a very beautiful hysteresis curve as a function of the in-plane rotation of the sample. And then this was the user from Bhuvaneshwar, where he had a magnetic nano dot samples, which was of the order of few microns. Even then, we can get a very good magnetism loop, and then at the same time, magnetic microstructure in the measurements. And some of the in-house results, probably this is again missing, where we could clearly see the cubic anisotropy in the samples, and then we could also see the frozen in and then rotatable spins in exchange bias systems by doing the measurements at low temperatures. And this was by measuring the transverse component of magnetization in addition to the longitudinal component, we could explain the exchange spring magnet samples. Probably you can just go to these papers for other details. Now, the last thing is, like all these thin films, the last thing I wanted to talk about is about our thin film X-ray diffractometer. Very quickly, we have a very good system, thin film X-ray diffractometer in our consortium, which can be, I think this Cradle photo has been missed here, but essentially the basic strength of this system is the Cradle, where we have all these degrees of freedom. Like we can tilt the sample, we can rotate the sample in plane, and then we have XYZ displacement, XYZ motion of sample. So this system is effectively used and extensively used by many users to measure, say for example, to characterize the polycrystalline and then epitaxial thin films. Like we do very routinely X-ray reflectivity, grazing incidence diffraction, five scans, reciprocal space mapping, and so on and so forth. So all these details are available in our website. So like in reflectivity, what essentially we do is we measure the reflected intensity as a function of the incident angle, and then we have what is known as a total external reflection angle, and this is proportional to the delta, which is nothing but proportional to the electron density. So therefore, by measuring this angle, one can clearly find out the electron density, that is, one can get the information about the chemical state, I mean, the chemical information of the sample. So this, this just to indicate this, just to show you that if your sample is highly smooth or if the sample is rough, how the reflectivity pattern changes. Probably I'll skip this, but essentially this is how the reflectivity pattern looks, and then one can get various information like critical angle that gives the density, and then amplitude of the oscillations gives the surface sensitivity, roughness of the sample. And then the important thing is one can get this thickness, roughness, and then electron density of the sample non-destructively by measuring the X-ray reflectivity. And then if you have a multi-layer sample, this is how the X-ray reflectivity pattern looks like, because you have a multi-layer periodicity. So this periodicity will be appeared as a function in terms of the Bragg reflection in the data. This is some missing here. And then in the case of GA-XRD, since in the thin films, essentially you're interested only in the surface of the sample. So what we do is we do the X-ray diffraction at low angles of incidence, which is known as the grazing incidence X-ray diffraction. So these are the X-ray reflectivity and then grazing incidence diffraction we routinely do for variety of samples, polycrystalline samples. Apart from this, we also do a lot of epitaxial thin films characterization. And then epitax are basically when you do a single crystal sample, when you grow samples on single crystal substrates, depending on their lattice parameters, either you can have a compressive strain or you can have a tensile strain, and then you can have a relaxed layer. So all these samples characterization requires not only the out-of-plane X-ray diffraction measurements, rather it requires the in-plane X-ray diffraction measurements. And that also we do very routinely. Say, for example, this is the PI scan of the sample, which shows that the sample is, in fact, this is about the substrate and this is the film. And this clearly shows the four-fold symmetry here. And the layer also is following, mimicking the four-fold symmetry, indicating that there is a cube-on-cube growth in the samples. In addition to these PI scans, we generally do, So we generally do the reciprocal space mapping, and then to know whether it is completely relaxed or whether it is completely strained, these kind of measurements we also do very routinely. I think something is missing here. And this is again the data measured at slightly. We have a very small homemade heater which can go up to say 130 degrees centigrade. We can do these X-ray measurements up to 130 degrees centigrade. With this, I'll thank everyone, and then thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Raghavendra. It was a very informative talk, and with such a wide array of facilities and expertise available in CSIR, this makes one of the best facilities available for the university researchers in the country. So I'll have two quick questions for you. One is about the what is the lowest temperature you can do mass spec spectroscopy? What is the lowest temperature limit?
The lowest temperature routinely we can do up to 4.2 Kelvin, and with the pumping we can go down to 1.5 to 2 Kelvin, but that requires pumping of the helium. And then unless there is a specific requirement, say for example in one of the sample we know the transition was below 4 Kelvin, so we had gone there, we went up to 1.2 Kelvin.
Okay.
But otherwise, we are very comfortable up to 4.2 Kelvin.
Okay. And second question is from a user, student. So she wants to know if the Moskva spectroscopy measurements can be done on ferrofluid samples.
The only thing is, if it is a fluid sample, no, we cannot do it. You can dry it, and then we need to have some sort of bonding in the sample. I mean, otherwise the net factor will be very, very low, Mosbauer F factor. So in principle, we will not get the signal.
Okay.
And there are some literature, where people have done these kind of ferrofluid samples. So probably they can disperse it in some polymers or something like that. They can work out the sample preparation. The measurements are possible, of course.
Okay. And the last question is about the proposal, which you said that CSIR proposals which can be submitted. So the question is, how much time does it take to get the proposals evaluated?
This is for one-time measurements. It depends on the measurement. Like if it is a Mossbauer measurements and if he wants to measure 25 samples, then my 1 year time is gone. Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, it all depends on the proposal. If it is a routine measurements, probably it will be done very quickly. And again, if it is, it depends on the sample and then it depends on the proposal measurement. But I'm sure in our consortium, mostly, they do it very fast. And then if there is any, if you don't get any response from the concerned faculty, you can always write to our center director. I mean, he will take care of your proposal.
Sure.
Otherwise, now with this through user portal, online user portal, now things are very clear. Everybody, the user office follows up the proposals.
Okay.
But sometimes it can delay mainly because the proposal is not very clear, and it is not like I have a system and then I do measurements at 5 Kelvin, 10 Kelvin, 20 Kelvin, 30 Kelvin. I mean, this really has to be justified. The proposal has to be justified. And I think immediately there will be a response.
Yeah, I mean, some feasibility has to be there.
Yes. Yeah, that is true. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Reddy, for your time and your very informative talk. Thank you very much. And maybe we'll take a five minutes break.
Yeah, maybe 5 to 10 minutes. I think our Dr. Fases are either
here. Okay. So he's ready then?
We'll just load the presentation.
Okay.
Maybe 10 minutes.
Okay. Is that okay, Dr. Samantha? You can.
Yes, sir. Fine. Okay, that's okay. We'll be holding up. We are here only.
Okay.
So whenever he joins, so we can have. But I'll do. So you please let me know when to connect. Okay.
Okay. Fine. Thank you.
Rest of you. Thank you.
Morning, sir. I will just take few minutes. I think we'll load the next session.
Good morning. How is the indoor weather now?
It started slightly cold. For me, it starts much early actually.
It's cold already.
Dr. Reddy, since you are still online, there's one question if you can answer, which says that can you conduct low temperature MOSBAR with both iron and tin sources? Dr. Reddy.
Yes, we can measure both the things at low temperatures.
Okay.
But not simultaneously, one after the other, okay?
Okay.
I mean, tin also, the example that I have shown was barium titanate tin dope was at low temperatures.
Okay.
And then high temperature also, we can go up to say, for example, 800 Kelvin without any magnetic field. From room temperature to high temperature also, we can go.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
There is a 5-minute break, so please be with us. We are going to continue with the second lecture in a few minutes.
Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning, sir.
Good morning, good morning, sir.
Sir, ready? Full screen, control S.
So for the second lecture from UGC DACSR Indore Center, Dr. DM Fase is with us. So welcome, Dr. Fase.
Hello.
Welcome, Dr. Fase. Sir, yes. I'm taking you live with your slides. So with your opening remark, then I will taking you directly with your slides.
Good morning, or rather good afternoon to all. I'm Dr. Fase from UGC DACSR Indore. Recently, I have taken the charge of central director here, so I'm looking after the facilities at the Indore Center, and mainly I'm looking after the Indus Synchrotron facilities, that is DAE Mega facilities, which we are sharing for the university users. So we have already developed lot of instrumentation around that Indus 1 and Indus 2. So I am going to talk about that thing. So Ajay, can I start my?
Yes, sir. You are live with your slides now. Yes, please, sir.
So the topic of my talk is Indus Synchrotrons, opportunities for research in condensed matter physics. एंटर करने अजय स्लाइड थोड़ा आगे नहीं जा रहा है
maybe little time lag is there maybe can
try. सर एरो दबाइए एरो करके देखिए
हाँ ओके ओके थैंक यू So the today's plan of talk is basically I will tell you about the introduction about the general synchrotron and then about Indus synchrotron because I think lot of people are new for this type of subject the synchrotron radiation time kind of thing so I will give the introduction then I will basically we have developed the two beam lines on this Indus 1 and Indus 2 so I will first I will tell about the photoelectron spectroscopy beam line on this Indus 1 by UGC DACSR and then I will tell about some of the results and how one can use this beamline for the condensed matter physics research. So I will show some results on synchrotron based XPS studies and then I will tell about the other beamlines on Indus 1 and Indus 2 that is from RRCAT as well as from BRC people and what kind type of research one can do using that beamlines. And then I will go for the our second beamline which we have developed on the Indus 2 that is soft X-ray absorption spectroscopy beamline and which will be basically developed for the X-ray magnetic circular diagram which is the basically new subject. Our earlier speaker already introduced that what type of magnetic measurements we are doing in our consortium and this is some additional facilities which we have developed in last couple of years. So I will tell in details about that soft X-ray absorption beamline. Specifically for the X-ray magnetic circular diagram. So I will give the one example of XMCD and I will show how one can use it for the magnetic properties. And then I will conclude my talk with the future plan and conclusions. So basically what is synchrotron radiation source? The synchrotron source is the electromagnetic radiation emitted when electrons moving at velocities close to the speed of light are forced to change direction under the action of magnetic field. So basically electron is moving in the circular path and when it passes through the magnetic field, there are basically the electromagnets are kept in the path of the electron, and because of that thing, the bending will be there, and where the bending is there, the energy loss will be there, and that energy loss is converted into the photon beam. So photon beam will come out at the each tangential point of the magnetic field. So electromagnetic radiation that is emitted in a very narrow cone in the forward direction at a tangent to the electron orbit, and the synchrotron light is basically unique in its intensity. You know that for most of the spectroscopic and microscopic experiment, we require the light source or photon source. But in laboratory, you will see that the, whatever the laboratory sources are available, the intensity of that source is very small as compared to the synchrotron source. So that's why the resolution and other thing which we are get in the laboratory, for example, in photoelectron spectroscopy, so the, you require a very large quantity of this thing for, then again for the concentration analysis of the material, suppose the very small concentration is there, for example, in EDASC type of experiment, in the laboratory, you will require the very large quantity inside. So minimum quantity required for the synchrotron radiation, because of the highest intensity, you will require the very small quantity of the sample, and that small quantity of the sample will give you the signal, very good quality signal with very good resolution. So that is the advantage of synchrotron radiation source. It has a very high intensity and a brilliance, and it can be generated across the range of electromagnetic spectrum. So any kind of in principle spectroscopy can, or microscopy can be done by the synchrotron radiation source. So depending upon the optics and depending upon the experimentation you have put in front of the synchrotron radiation beam, you will decide what type of experiment one can do. So there are large variety of experiment one can do. And another advantage is all these beams are coming simultaneously from the each bending magnet. So you can keep the various measurement at a time in around the one circle of the synchrotron radiation ring. So that is the advantage of this thing. And the energy range which is available is from infrared to the X-ray. So all kind of spectroscopy, all kind of microscopes can be arranged around this synchrotron radiation. So that is the advantage of synchrotron radiation. So if you compare the intensity of these light sources, I will go from the candle light. So candle light, it is basically on the y-axis I have shown the brightness, that is photons per second per mm square and millirad square 0.1% of bandwidth. So you can see that the candle is around 10 raised to 5, and then 60 watt light bulb is around 10 raised to 6. Then normally laboratory X-ray tube, which where you do the X-ray diffraction or X-ray lavae type of experiment. So basically that is the 10 raised to 8 to 10 raised to 10, and which is equivalent to the sunlight. So in laboratory sources, we are in sunlight, but sunlight is basically diverging, and all these things require the focusing type of objects. And then if you compare the synchrotron radiation, then normal bending magnet, that is the first generation or second generation synchrotron radiation sources are basically around 10 to 15. So the very huge difference between the laboratory kind of thing, X-ray tube and this bending magnet. And then people have developed some insertion devices around these bending magnets. So that's why, because of these insertion devices, undulators and wigglers, so the intensity can still go up from the 18 to 10 to 20 kind of thing. So these are basically the third generation light sources where these undulators and wiggler kind of beam lines are available on this synchrotron radiation source. What are the advantages of the synchrotron source, overlap source? Basically, I have told you that it is from the IR to X-ray. So it is a continuous spectrum from IR to X-ray. Then emission is very narrow in solid angle. So from 0.1 millirad to the 1 millirad. So that is another advantage. So you don't have to worry about the, because it's sunlight is also available, but sunlight, when it reach up to the earth, the basically it is the emission is in the divergent type of thing. So that's why you will not get the full intensity at the experimental point. So here basically the emission is in very small angle. So that's why you can get the total intensity, whatever is radiated from that point source or that bending magnet point. So that will be come out and that will reach up to the, your sample. So that is the basically the advantage of the small emission. And then the third one is basically the pulse time structure. This basically radiation is having the pulse time structure, and pulse duration is as short as 50 picoseconds. So one can arrange the time resort experiments also using this synchrotron radiation. So that is another advantage. And the fourth advantage is basically this radiation is having the very high degree of polarization. So when it comes into the orbit of the main where the electron beam is moving. In that plane, basically it is the linear in the linear polarization, and if you go up and down, it's elliptically above and below plane of the orbit. So that is the advantage of the synchrotron radiation source. And because of this polarization, I will tell you in the last of this thing, my talk, what is the use of this polarization to do the magnetic kind of measurement. However, as compared to the laboratory experiment and the synchrotron radiation experiment, there is a difference between the two kind of thing, because in laboratory you have the source, and immediately after that source some small optics is there, and that optics, and then you have the experimental, your sample holder or experimental station or whatever thing you are put there. But here basically, since it is the accelerator kind of business, one should have the shielding around the synchrotron radiation source. And because of the shielding, the lot of space is gone inside this, all the ring and other thing will be the inside. So the actual tapping, you are tapping the beam very away from that exact output of that bending magnet. So that's why in between you required a lot of kind of optics to focus the thing, to collect the beam, to focus the beam. And that kind of optics is basically called the beamline of this. So basically there are three kinds of people are required for the doing this thing. Basically the machine people are there to generate this synchrotron radiation. Then beamline experts are there. They basically they are expert in optics and other kind of things. So they can develop the thing depending upon your requirement of kind of beam, what kind of energy and what kind of intensity you required for your experiment. So accordingly, they will design the optics for this thing. And then so they are called basically the beamline scientists. And then finally, the physicist or scientist come, who is basically the main user of this machine. So what kind of experiment, for example, photoelectron spectroscopy, then photo spectroscopy is nearer. If it is micro X-ray diffraction and other kind of thing, then X-ray expert is needed there. So that is basically the experimental scientist is needed. So three kind of people, it is basically the collaboration between the, all the three kinds of people. So machine people are also important. Unless you get them, you will not get the beam. Then beamline scientists are also important, and physicists are also important. Physicist or chemist or any scientist, depending upon the subject of his expert. So that kind of collaboration is needed for this kind of experiment. So then what type of beamlines are there? Basically, you have seen that it is from the IR to X-rays. So that's why basically the two kind of optics. One is basically the soft X-ray optics, and one is basically the hard X-ray optics. So basically, the in the soft X-ray optics, you will require the different kind of gratings are required. And then all other things are there. Same, for example, source, you have to collect the beam. So for collecting the beam, you have the collimating mirror or deflection mirror. And then you have the slits structure there. And then you have, depending upon the required energy range, you have to select the gratings. And from that grating, you will get the soft X-ray or ultraviolet kind of thing, energy range. And then again, once the grating beam is deflected from the grating, you have to again collect it, focus it onto sample. So there's again, you require another kind of mirror. So basically the pre-mirror, post-mirror, and in between you have the monochromator. So this kind of optics is required for this beamline kind of purpose. So basically in the soft X-ray, you have the optics is basically the grating-based optics. And in the hard X-ray, you are basically the crystal kind of optics in there. This is our Indus complex. You can see that basically it started from here. It is basically the source of the electron, that is the microton, 20 MeV, 30 milliampere. Then it is basically the transfer line. That transfer line take the beam in that our beam from the microton to the booster. So this is the basically the booster synchrotron, where the energy can go up to the 550 MeV and the current will be around 10 milliampere. So for the Indus 1 ring is basically the storage ring where the beamline are basically installed. So this Indus 1 ring is basically 450 MeV and 100 milliampere. And where the so if you want to inject the beam into the Indus 1, you can boost up to the 450 MeV, and then you can inject this Indus 1 synchrotron, and then you can close this transfer line, and then you can put the beam into the Indus 2, which is basically the hard X-ray beam, basically 2.5 GeV and 300 milliampere. Here basically soft X-ray and hard X-ray both are there in this intensity, and here Indus 1 basically the vacuum ultraviolet and the soft X-rays are there. So these are basically the two synchrotrons, Indus synchrotrons available for the users at the RR CAT complex of the Department of Atomic Energy. And both the synchrotron Indus 1 and Indus 2 are open in three shift mode since February 2003. So on this Indus 1, basically the small ring, the 450 MeV, there are basically the five beam lines, the soft X-ray reflectivity, angle integrated photo emission, this red color that we have developed. Others are by RRCAT and BRC. One is another is angle resolved photo emission spectroscopy. Another one is photophysics, that spectroscopy beamline, and then high resolution vacuum ultraviolet beamline. So these three are from the BRC, one is from the RRCAT, and one is from the UGCTACSR. So I will talk about this UGCTACSR beamline. So this is our AIPS beamline on Indus 1. This beamline is designed and developed by the UGCTACSR. Beamline successfully installed on Indus 1 in the year November 2000. So it is now 20 years we have completed this beamline in operation continuously. You can see that this is actually the beamline. It is the pre-mirror where the beam is collected and beam is focused on the internal slit of this monochromator. This is complete monochromator, grating monochromator. Basically, this is the grating chamber. In this grating chamber, there are three grating. This is the grating electronics, motor and other thing to change the grating and to scan the grating. And then here basically you have the exit slit, and then the beam is focused of the required energy is focused on the exit slit of this monochromator, and then again the post mirror will bend that beam and it will focus, it will take the beam to the your sample. Basically this is the photoelectron spectrometer. I will show you the station in the next slide. So this is basically the whole thing, and since this is the soft X-ray and vacuum ultraviolet kind of range, you require the ultra high vacuum for all the beam line. So your station is connected to the beam line as well as the synchrotron through this ultra vacuum line. So there is you have to take very much care of the vacuum in your experimental chamber, so that the vacuum inside the beam line as well as inside the synchrotron ring should not get disturbed because of the your handling of the experimental station. So that is the must for this thing. So you should have the training of the ultra vacuum, how to generate the ultra vacuum, how to open these gate walls and other thing, how to check the vacuum levels, and then you can start your experiment. Not like in our lab, because if you disturb vacuum of this your line, then that will disturb the all the beam lines which are connected on this industrial proton storage thing. So that's why you have to very much careful about doing this experiment as it done in the ultra vacuum. So that is the basically most important condition to operate this beam line. So this is the experimental station. I have shown you this experimental station here. This is the normal photoelectron spectrometer which is available in the any laboratory kind of thing. Only difference between the our measurements and laboratory measurement is that here we can tune the photon energy. In laboratory you have only the fixed energy photon sources. For example, for a valence band study you have the helium 1 and helium 2 sources. And for a ESCA kind of thing, for chemical analysis, you have the aluminum K alpha or copper K alpha kind, magnesium K alpha kind of sources are available there. All other electronics and other things are same. Everything is same. Only thing is that the source is different as far as the photoelectron spectroscopy beamline is concerned. So this station was basically commercial spectrometer from the Omicron. We have installed it in the 2004. So from last 14 to 15 years, we are working on this beam, and continuously this beamline is under 10 raised to minus 10 torr of ultra high vacuum. So we are very much satisfied with the performance of this thing. And now we are thinking of changing this thing, because now the very new kind of stations are available now for the with high resolutions and high kind of thing, and also the life of this analyzer has been completed. So very soon we will try to replace this analyzer, but I will show you the what kind of research we have done. And still it is basically one can do the research. That is not like we are going to discard this kind of experimental station. We will still continue with this kind of station, but we are planning to buy the new station also because of the requirement of the new problems of the new high, with new high resolution kind of spectrometer. So basically these are the beamline specifications. The source is bending magnet, acceptance angle is basically 10 millirad by 2.5 millirad, toroidal mirror is the first focus accepting mirror optics, then entrance and exit slit. Horizontally it is from 0.4 mm to 3 mm. Basically these slits are important as far as the resolution is concerned. If you vary the slit, then you will get the vary. Depending upon the required resolution, one can adjust the slit. Otherwise you can keep the fixed slits. Then the second mirror is taking the beam to your sample, and finally the spot size of the sample on sample, the beam is basically, this is very important as far as the users are concerned, because their sample should be bigger than this spot size. That is, so basically 5 mm by 5 mm sample spot size is there around the 5 mm diameter. So your sample should be greater than 5 mm by 5 mm. At least 1 cm by 5 mm sample is required for the measurement of this kind of on this beam line. And then the energy range is basically, we have the three gratings inside this monochromator. These are basically the 200 lines per mm, 600 lines per mm, 1800 plus lines per mm. That is platinum grating. And the energy range is basically in terms of angstrom, you have 540 to 1600, 180 to 540, and 60 to 180 angstrom. And in terms of electron volt, it is 10 to 23 eV, 23 to 69 eV, so 69 to 210 eV. So that is basically, you can see that the whole range is around 10 eV to 210 eV. So it is basically very good for the shallow kind of SPS measurement, and then basically the good for the ultraviolet photoelectron spectroscopy, because we have the very small energy of 10 eV is also possible, which is less than the your helium 1 line, which is available in the laboratory. So for normally for the valence band spectroscopy or ultraviolet photoelectron spectroscopy required a very small energy. So that's why this beam line is very advantageous to do the valence band kind of experiment. So this is the basically the layout of Indus 1 ring, and there are basically the 4 bending magnets, and these are the beam lines. So this is our second beam line is our, so BL2 on the Indus 1 is the IUC beam line, or UGC DACSR beam line of angle integrated photoelectron. This is the actual photograph of storage ring. You can see that these are the 4 bending magnets. This is the transfer line from where the electron beam is coming from the microtron or the booster synchrotron with the 450 mV, and it is injected and then it circulated in this storage ring, and all the beam lines are coming from each bending magnet corner. So here one beam line, you can see the second beam line, third beam line and fourth beam line. So this kind of, this is the basically the storage ring. This is small storage ring, so I can show you complete storage ring on in one picture. This is our beam line. I already showed you that this is pre mirror, then monochromator, this is a post mirror, and this is the experimental station. And this is the analyzer conduct. This is the other view. Here you can see the control system, control computer. You can see the spectrum is already there inside the thing. And this is the analyzer part of thing. And this is basically the first spectrum which we have tested, the beam line. This is for the core level spectrum. And this is 4F7/2, 4F5/2 spin orbit split doublet of this platinum core level. And since platinum core level falls below the 200 eV, so that's why we can do the core level spectroscopy of such kind of material. And this is the valence band spectrum of silver. You can see that. So this was the first spectrum which we had generated on the in 2000 when we have started operation of this beam line. And these are the specification of the workstation. You have the hemispherical analyzer, and for the, as far as the users are concerned, the argon ion gun is there for depth profiling study of sample, a diamond file to scrap the pelleted sample, then twin anode source is also there to for the parallel XPS measurement. Then sample heating and cooling is also possible in this experimental station. So heating is up to the 450 degree and cooling is up to the liquid nitrogen facility. Then magnetic sample transfer mechanism is there. So at a time, because since whole experiment has to be done under the ultra vacuum, so every time if you do the ultra vacuum, at least you should have the 3-4 sample inside your chamber, so that you can save the time and you can do the more number of sample in the one single shot measurement. So that's why the magnetic sample transfer mechanism is there. So and then before starting the your experiment, since it is the surface sensitive technique, you have to see the what are the residual gases inside this thing. So that's why residual gas analyzer is also available. And then suppose if somebody want to do some in situ depositions of thin films, ultra thin films or contact or coatings on your sample, then one can have the micro evaporator for this in situ deposition there. And the major resolution of the spectrometer is with XPS source, MGK alpha, it is 0.8 eV at pass energy 30 eV. And with the synchrotron radiation source, basically you have the 30 eV, 0.6 eV, for 10 TeV pass energy, you have 0.48 eV and 10 EV, you have the 0.4 EV or 0.39 EV is the basically the resolution which you are getting with this thin line. So these are basically the sum of the results. This is the platinum calibration. And the sum of the research carried out by the users is basically proton electron study by passive voltage gallium arsenide surface, then photoemission study of LCMO doped sample, basically oxide sample. Since we are doing the ex-situ measurement, most of the time we are expecting oxide sample because it is the surface sensitive technique. So if you, unless you have the some in-situ growth and other facility, one cannot do the metallic kind of thing. So valence band study of copper, Ag dope and electron beam irradiated volumide sample, core level and valence band photoemission investigation of low energy electron beam irradiated mylar and polyimide sample, silicon nitride photoelectron spectroscopy study, then laser irradiated stainless steel sample XPS study, photoelectron spectroscopy study of ferrite sampling. So these kind of sample type of variety of problems were studied by the different users. So I will go one by one the results for this thing. So basically you can see this is the valence band spectrum of Fe304 nanotips grown on the gallium arsenide substrate by pulse laser deposition. You can, there are basically the two spectrum, valence band spectrum. One is for the thick film of the Fe304, that is 150 nanometer. So it is showing like the bulk kind of thing. And then it is the nanotip sample. This is basically the AFM picture of this Fe304 nanotip, and you can see that this is the basically the valence band spectrum. You can see that the, as compared to the thicker sample, there is a change in the density of state near the Fermi energy of this nanotip kind of sample. So this kind of small variation in the thing can also be found out using this AIPS beamline. Then another advantage of this beamline is basically you can tune the photon energy for the valence band study. So one can do the resonant photoemission spectroscopy kind of experiment. So this resonant photoemission spectroscopy is basically advantage of the synchrotron radiation. In laboratory, one cannot perform this resonant photoemission spectroscopy. For example, there are basically in direct photoemission the process, the valence of d electron. You can see that this is the one way that P6 dn and then photon energy. Then you have the one electron is detected from the d level and the electron is detected. So this is the one process. And then when the energy of the incident photon is equal to the energy difference between the p core level and the valence d state, besides direct photoemission process, another photo absorption also occurs, which results subsequent OJ type decay. That is called basically the super Coster chronic decay. And that occurs with the following type, that is P6 dn h mu, P5 dn plus 1, P6 dn minus 1, and E minus 1. Since the final states of both these processes are basically the same, have the same electron configuration, and is therefore the quantum mechanical interference occurs, and the photoemission intensity is resonantly enhanced in such kind of effect. So that is called basically the resonant photoemission. So most of the people have done a lot of work on this resonant photoemission spectroscopy using this synchrotron radiation based AIPS beamline. So this is the basically one spectrum one can see how, what is the difference you get in the valence band when you vary the photon energy. So this is basically the Fe304 on gallium arsenide film by varying the incident photon energy from 40 to 50. You can see that the various minute changes are there, but they are basically definite changes around the, near the Fermi energy once you vary the energy from 40 EV to the 65 EV. Then another is basically the problem. Basically, nowadays a lot of people are working on the doped semi oxide systems. So that is also useful resonant photoemission spectroscopy in the, that kind of problem. So this is basically the one of the example of iron doped molybdenum oxide, where we have done the resonant photoemission spectroscopy. In this, basically we have doped the 0 to 5% iron in the molybdenum oxide matrix. And we have checked basically what is the changes in the molybdenum oxide valence band study. So these are the basically the at one energy, the 34 EV valence band. Initially, we have done the 34 EV valence band to find out the valence band regions, so what kind of regions are there. And then we have changed the photon energy. And there are basically the three samples. One is undoped sample, one is the 2% dope, one is the 5% dope. And then we vary the energy around from 34 EV to the 68 EV. So, and then we have minute changes were observed, and that minute changes were analyzed in proper function. And then we have plotted all the samples as a function of photon energy. We have the CIS intensity were plotted for all these samples, and from that what are the basically the variation of the different features what we have shown in the first valence band spectrum. So we have found out the variation in the valence band spectrum, and from that we have concluded that the feature in the valence band spectrum of both samples at banding energy 4.9 eV shows resonance peak around 56 eV, which is attributed to the iron hybridization. So we have shown that the iron and molybdenum states are hybridized in this oxide molybdenum oxide iron doped sample. So these are basically this kind of problems one can study using this resonance photoemission spectroscopy at this baseline. Then another is basically the origin of electron phase separation in the LCMO kind of substrate carried out by one of the students. So basically, this is he has deposited the LCMO sample on both two substrates. One is STO substrate and another is the LAO substrate, and you can see that its core level spectrum of both the spectrum, both the sample is basically the same. The core level XPS spectra doesn't show any variation because both the samples were deposited at the same time. However, if you see the valence band spectrum of this thing on this beamline, you can see that there is a variation around this valence band spectra for the STO and LAO. So that would basically the normalized valence band spectra of this thing. One can see the difference in the valence band spectra is clearly visible, and the insets show the variation in the DOS near the Fermi level. So you can see that the DOS near the Fermi level of the both the samples, though they have deposited at the same time, is also different. So that kind of minute differences also one can find out by doing this type of thing. Another is basically the LSMO sample, where basically the user has doped the iron kind of thing, and they have found out what is the effect of iron in this magnetite sample of this. So here you can see that change in the density of state. Again, they have found out for the iron doped sample. Very small changes, but definite changes were found out because of the high intensity beam of the synchrotron radiation. And then even nanoparticle also one can do using this synchrotron based photoelectron spectroscopy. This is one of the cadmium selenide nanoparticle magnetic and optical property study. So here basically you can see that variation in the valence band spectrum of the different doping, and these are basically the magnetization data. Then another is basically again the oxide sample, cerium oxide thin film grown on silicon substrate with pulse resolution. It is again the resonance photoemission study to find out the hybridization effect. So these kind of problems also one can plan using this thing. Then it is again the iron doped titanium oxide valence band study, which is again done by our group. These are the various things you required a lot of spectrum you have to generate, you have to vary the energy, you have to, and also it depend upon how much samples you are having, how much doping, different doping you are having. So that will decide how much time is required to carry out the whole experiment on this beamline. And then this is the another kind of measurement people are doing very regularly on this beamline, that is the band. Nowadays people are doing some heterostructure then of thin films. For example, this is the cadmium zinc oxide, cadmium of zinc oxide type of bilayer film, and there basically one can put the beam in the zinc oxide as well as the cadmium doped zinc oxide, and then you can measure the photoelectron spectra or valence band spectra and then find out the band offset measurement. So that kind of experiments also one can do using this beamline. And then suppose if you have totally new sample and you have to find out the electronic structure, then one can do also by using this beamline. So this is one of the example of electronic structure of CEAG2GE2 studied by the resonance photoemission spectroscopy. So these are basically the lot of spectrums where they generated from the valence band spectra, and then this is theoretical calculations were matched with the experimental data which we have generated through this beamline. So that kind of experiment also one can find out of the unknown electronic structure one can find out using this valence band study at this beamline. So these are the different publications come out from this beamline from last 15 years, and these are basically available on our website. You can see that thing and you can find out and you can, it will be useful for you to design the problem to work on this beamline. So all are welcome to work on this beamline. So I will go to the next part of this my talk, that is different beamline on this industry one. So these are the other beam line. One is soft X-ray beam line by the RRCAT people. That energy range is 40 angstrom to the 1000 angstrom. This is our, I already told you. Then angle resolved photoemission spectroscopy beam line by the BRC. That is 40 angstrom to the 1000. Then photophysics beam line by BRC. And then high resolution vacuum ultraviolet spectroscopy object. So these are basically, this is not more useful for the condensed matter people. These two are, but this angle resolved photoemission spectroscopy can be used by the condensed matter physicists for the electron structural study. So I will just show the one pictures and the specification of this beamline. One is the soft X-ray beamline. This can be used for the thin film thickness measurement as well as the of the study of the electron density of these thin films, whether and what is the difference between the bulk character and the thin film character of the same material. So that kind of study one can do using this reflectivity beamline. So the energy range is 4 nanometer to the 100, angular resolution is 0.01 degree centigrade, and the typical studies are interface characterization, porosity of the thin film, and the determination of the optical constants. So these are the one can plan studies on this reflectivity beamline. Another one is basically the high resolution VUV beamline. Energy range is 4 to 12 eV, and then resolution is 0.1 angstrom. Then off-plane Eagle Mount spectrometer is there, and then VU photo absorption studies, atoms and molecular. So most of the basically the spectroscopy people can use this beamline. Then this is the photophysics beamline, call it by BRC. The wavelength range is 50 nanometer to 350 nanometer. Wavelength range is again for gases 110 nanometer to 350 nanometer. So both basically gas type of spectroscopy as well as solid spectroscopy, solid matrix isolation spectroscopy can be done. So samples are basically solid, liquid, and gases, and one can go up to the temperature variation is also there. So up to 10K also one can go in this experimental station for the photophysics beamline. And this basically the angle resolved photoelectron spectroscopy. One can do photoelectron spectroscopy in angle resolved manner on this BRC beamline. The energy range is again 4 nanometer to the 100 nanometer. Resolution is around 0.3 eV. It is similar to our thing. Only thing is the difference is that here you can do the angle resolved kind of measurement. Then I will now shift to the Indus 2 synchrotron storage ring, that bigger ring of the hard X-ray as well as the soft X-ray kind of thing. So there are basically the 26 ports were available. So 26 beamline in principle are possible. Right now, basically there are dispersive exhaust, energy dispersive X-ray diffraction, angle dispersive X-ray diffraction, X-ray fluorescence microprobe, X-ray lithography, X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, and then this protein crystallography, scanning exhaust, visible diagnostic, and this red color polarized light beamline, what I am going to tell you about this beamline, and then imaging beamline. So these are basically the working beamline. I will go one by one of this beamline. So basically the angle dispersive X-ray diffraction beamline, it is basically the energy range is 5 kV to 2. In normally in laboratory, people are doing on the copper K alpha source at 8 kV, but here basically the range is available, so 5 kV to 20 kV, and energy resolution is again delta E by delta is around 5000 at 9 kV, and the beam size is very small. One can focus that beam to 0.5 mm to 0.6 mm. And then basically Huber diffractometer, here basically very high accuracy of the resolution, 0.0002 degree moment one can do. And here image plating also available there for the X-ray diffraction meter. So these are the basic, also temperature dependent facility is attached to this angle dispersive X-ray diffraction. Here basically one of the example is shown of the barium titanate. One can have the phase transition studies kind of thing using this beamline. So this does such kind of problem one can address by using this beamline. You know, the temperature range available is around 3K to the 450 kV. Liquid helium based system is possible there. So one can have the phase transition kind of studies of in X-ray diffraction or at this beamline. This is the high pressure facility also available on this beamline at the angle dispersive X-ray. So one can do the pressure dependent phase transition studies also using this angle dispersive. Dr. A.K. Sinha is basically the in charge for this beamline. One can contact if anybody is interested to do this kind of beamline. So these are basically the example of high pressure application. And then there is another, basically two beamlines are available. For example, this exhaust for studies, that exhaust is basically dispersive exhaust and angle resolved exam. So basically, experimental, it is the experimental precision, and low temperature is also there, and the energy range is around 5 kV to 20 kV, and beam size is around 0.2 mm to 0.4 mm. The sample environment is again up to the 5 K to room temperature, and high temperature setup up to the 450 degrees centigrade. So these are the basically BRC beamline. Dr. S.N. Jha is basically in charge for this beamline. And then another is the scanning exam. Then they are basically the 4 kV, 25 kV. Resolution is again 10,000 at 10 kV. CCR up to the 4 K is available. And lytal detector for fluorescence exhaust measurement also possible on this. So fluorescence exhaust is also possible, and normal scanning exhaust is also possible on this data. So these are basically the one of the results for these exhausts. Even liquid solutions also one can do the exhaust. Then there is one of the important application of X-ray fluorescence. Basically, a microprobe type of beamline is available by the RRCAT people there. The energy range is again 4 kV to 20 kV. Energy resolution is 5000. And the variation optional operational modes are there. Monochromatic focus mode, monochromatic unfocused, colorimetric mode is also possible. And these is basically the beamline is used for microprobe mapping of the multi-element sample, trace element detection, typically PPM level, then X-ray imaging, absorption contrast, and the fluorescent mode X-ray absorption kind of thing. So these are basically the beamline for the microprobe application. And Dr. N.K. Tiwari is the basically in charge from the RRCAT for this beamline. All these details of their emails and other addresses are available on the Indus website. You can contact if anybody is interested to do the measurement on these beamlines. So this is basically one of the X-ray fluorescent applications where one can have the contrast images of the different materials present in the sample. So this is basically the optical micrograph of fluorescent intensity distribution from the human hair. They are basically sulfur, potassium, copper, and zinc. They are basically of the different colors one can see in the fluorescent application. And then energy dispersive X-ray diffraction beamline. Already we have seen the angle dispersive X-ray diffraction beamline by Dr. A.K. Sinha, and this is energy dispersive X-ray diffraction beamline. Here basically most of the in situ kind of measurement one can do using this X-ray diffraction beamline. The energy range is 10 kV. This is by BRC people, and then angular range is again plus minus 25. Q range is 1.3 to 9.2 angstrom inverse. And detector resolution is around 145 UV at 5.9 kV and 475 UV at the 122 kV. So, and these are useful for the high pressure and high temperature studies. High temperature furnace up to the 1200 degree centigrade is available. Sample is constrained geometry and well suited for the kinetic studies. So that is basically the advantage of this energy dispersive beamline over the angle dispersive beamline. And then one of the imaging beamline is also available. This beamline operates in the energy range of 5 kV to 35 kV. Detectors available include CCD camera, X-ray microscope, flat panel detector, and high resolution imaging. The experiments possible on these beamlines are absorption and phase contrast imaging, dual energy radiography, laminography, mammography, monochromatic and white imaging is also possible on this beamline. So this is basically the beamline for the imaging study. And then this is for the this is not for the condensed matter, but it is proton, just for the sake of completeness I am telling this. Protein crystallography is one of the important beamline on this Indus 2. The energy range is again 5 kV to 25 kV. We here basically the CCD detector for data acquisition, fluorescent detector is also there, and temperature dependent is also there. So the and biochemical, good quality biochemical laboratory is also equipped with all facilities to prepare protein crystal from gene cloning. So this is basically very good quality facility available for the university researcher in this field of area of protein crystallography. And then one another thing is all other beamlines you see that they are for the characterization of this thing, but another, this is the beamline where one can do the nanostructures and other kind of thing. This is basically the X-ray lithography. Normally similar to the electron beam lithography, one can do the X-ray lithography kind of thing. So one can generate the nano patterns, the nano dots and other kind of thing. So this is basically the X-ray lithography by the RRCAT scientist. This is the layout of the beamline. This is the mirror box system, and this is the main parameter of the beamline. The 4 kV to 20 kV beam size at the sample position, and then environment is vacuum. One can have the helium gas also. One can have the air also. then mask to substrate size is around 100 mm and gap between mask and resistor is this, and mask resistor gap resolution is around 1 mm there. So these are the basically various beamlines available on Indus 2. So now I will go for the last part of my talk, that is our beamline on this Indus 2, that is for the magnetic measurement, that X-ray absorption spectroscopy for the magnetic measurement. So this is basically the, initially I told you that the advantage of synchrotron beam is, that is the one of the advantages, basically it has the polarization. The polarization that basically in plane of your electron beam, the polarization is linear, and above and below it is basically the angular kind of thing. The circular kind of polarization is available. So if you tap the beam above the plane of electron beam, then one can get a polarized light from this beam. And to take the advantage of that polarized light beam, we have designed and developed this polarized light beamline on this Indus 2. The objective of basically the soft X-ray absorption spectroscopy beamline on bending magnet for X-ray magnetic circular light resonance study. The developed facility will be used to investigate the macroscopic origin of magnetic properties. Most of the people working in the magnetic materials are visiting our institute, and other facilities are also they are using. So it will be, so we have decided to go for this magnetic measurement, because there is all other facilities are available on this Indus synchrotron, but magnetic measurements are not possible. So that's why we decided to go for this development, and we have developed this beamline for the magnetic measurement. So I will tell you about this beamline. Basically, before going that, what is basically the XMCD? So XMCD is the difference spectrum of two X-ray absorption spectra. So you have to do the absorption measurement in two ways. One is by left circular polarized light and by right circular. And both are available on this synchrotron, because if you can tap the radiation above and below the electron path of this. So one with the right circular, and then you can find out the difference between the two absorption spectra where you can get the XMCD spectrum. So that is the way one can find out this thing. And then this will give the information about the pitch spin and orbital magnetic moment of it. So such kind of measurement is not possible with other techniques. So that's why this is very important technique as far as the magnetic materials are concerned. So what are the advantages of this thing? That this method is very sensitive even for the systems having small amount of magnetic atoms, like magnetic submonolayer, film, nanostructure, and dilute magnetic system. To determine separately the contribution to magnetic moment by different constituting elements of magnetic system, that is element specificity, and then further retrieve the orbital and spin contribution to the magnetic moment of different elements present in the material. Microscopic origin of magnetic anisotropy can also be determined using this XMCD technique. So what is the basic requirement for this XMCD experiment? Basically, you require the circularly polarized light. So either for a bending magnet, broader energy range, less photon flux, then moderate percent polarization. And another one is basically the insertion devices. The insertion devices take a long time. Already people are trying on the Indus 2. RRCAT is developing one of the beamline on around insertion design. But till then, people can get training on this kind of thing, what type of experiment. Because in our country, basically, few people know about this technique. So one can generate the, get the training, and one can enter into this new kind of field for the magnetic measurement. So one can, and still one can get good quality MCD spectra using the bending magnet, because here moderate polarization is also available. Not 100% polarized light, but moderate polarization is sufficient for the XMCD experiment. This is the optimization which we have done. For example, how percentage polarization go if you go above the plane of the electron beam. So basically, it depends on energy also. So basically, one can see that about 80% polarization is available, 80 to 90% polarization is available if you go to the 0.4 to 0.5 millirad above the beam of this linear. And this is again how the intensity falls down. If you go above the beam from the central point of the synchrotron polarization, so if it's 0 degree, you have the highest plus. And if you go to the 0.12, 0.22, 0.32, so if you go to the 0.22 or 0.3, you can see that there is very less reduction in the flux of this intensity. So one can adjust your first polarization, first chamber accordingly. You can tap the beam about the 0.22, then you will get the polarized light from this thing. So that was the idea of doing this beamline around the bending magnet. So here basically we have one put the polarization aperture. All other optics is same as in our polar photoemission beamline. They are basically pre-mirror, post-mirror, and grating, basically all around the same kind of thing. So energy range is around 10 eV to the 1000 eV. And then this polarization aperture, depending upon the polarization aperture position, you will get the percentage polarization of the beam. So that is the idea of doing the this. So we can do the one experiment using the by putting the aperture above and one putting the above below. Or another thing is that anyway you are putting the magnetic field around the sample. If you keep fixed your polarization aperture at one position, for example, for right circular polarization or left circular, here you can change the magnetic field direction around your sample chamber. So that is also possible, and that way also one can do the extensity measurement. So these are basically the ray tracing result. You can see the spot of the size by both the way. One can be getting the same flux around up and down aperture. And then these are the basically the resolving power around 2500 to 5000 throughout the whole energy range, whatever energy range which we have decided for the 10 eV to the 1200 eV. One can get this type of resolution for the X-ray absorption study with this polarization aperture. This is basically the engineering drawing that I skip. These are basically the final specification of our XMCD beamline. So this is bending magnet. Acceptance angle is 5 millirad to the 1.5. Polarization selection, fixed polarization selection chamber, including stand with 4 working position. Then pre-mirror, water-cooled toroidal mirror to focus the SR beam. Then slits are there for control the resolution. And the post-mirror is again to focus the sample. Focus the beam on the sample, and energy range is around 100 eV. So normal X-rays experiment are also possible, and XMCD and XMLD type of them. Linear dichroism is also possible on this beam line. So this is the actual beam one can see at the entrance lid, and then after grating, we can have the focus spot there. And this is the final spot on our system. And this is the first X-ray absorption spectrum. This beam line was started operating from 17th May 2013. This is the in the absorption mode. So this is the first absorption spectrum of this beamline. And then these are some preliminary. A lot of people were using for the normal X-ray mode of this beamline. So these are the X-ray measurement using prototype external rotation, and now being routinely carried out. Some examples are shown in figure 1 and 2. This is the X-ray pattern of iron nitride at iron L3 L2 edge, X-ray pattern of LCMO and aluminum dope, LCMO taken at MNL edge. Very good quality data you can get of the X-ray absorption spectroscopy on this beamline. You can see the different kind of samples which we have done on this beamline from the different users. One is from the SNU UP, then Ravanam IGCAR Tamil Nadu, then Balasubramanian IIT Roorkee. You can see that very good quality, and this data is basically as compared to our AIPS beamline, because that is basically whole process is in ultra vacuum. This is also ultra vacuum, but here the data acquisition is very fast. So basically you are getting the spectrum within a few minutes. This full spectrum one can generate in 2 minutes. So that's why we can have the very high throughput of this beamline of users. So this is the different examples. I will not give details. One can go to the various paper published by the people on this beamline. And then I will tell you about the story of XMCD workstation. The experimental workstation capable of performing X-ray absorption magnetic linear dichroism experiment will be necessary. So this workstation should be ultra vacuum chamber, and XYZ manipulator is required. So these are basically requirement, and this is basically the picture. What type of electromagnetic necessary for the XMCD experiment? One can have the vacuum chamber inside the sample with manipulator, XYZ manipulator, and the magnetic field should be in this direction there. So this way we have designed this chamber, and we have got this electromagnet and this chamber, and finally we have installed this XMCD station. And this is basically the frequency of changing the magnetic field from positive to negative kind of thing. So there we are fixing the polarization at the one side, and we are changing the magnetic field direction. So that is the way we are doing the XMCD experiment. Maximum field available is around 2 Tesla, and basically field reversal time is around 0.2 seconds is available here. And the measurement mode is basically the total electron field mode. So this is the first spectrum which we have generated by using this XMCD station. and 2018, and very good quality XMCD spectrum, even though it is on the bending magnet and not on the undulator kind of. Again, I am showing the same transparency where which I showed you for the nano tips of the valence band, and the same sample we have used it for the XMCD kind of measurement. So basically, it is the thickness dependent in between the 2 nanometer and the 150 nanometer. So basically, one is the nano tip kind of sample, one is the continuous thin film, the bulk kind of thing. So what is the difference between the XMCD of this sample? So that we have studied. So basically, two type of absorption spectrum were generated with left circular and right circular, and we have found out the XMCD between the both the samples. We showed the XMCD signal. One is 2 nanometer and one is 150 nanometer. Both samples showed good quality XMCD spectrum. And then we have done the analysis, whole analysis by our student Gyanendra Panchal, and he has found out that finally in 150 nanometer sample, normally the your orbital part is basically the quince, basically around zero you are getting the orbital contribution, and spin contribution is around 3.9, and in this 2 nanometer film you are getting the orbital contributions, that is 1.4. so that is the difference between the nano magnetic properties of this nano tips and this bulk sample. So this is the paper which we have published from the first paper of on this XMCD. This is the first paper on XMCD from the India, from Indian synchrotron. And so finally, there are future plan to go for the XMCD that is underway. Very soon we will come out with the low temperature attachment for the XMCD station, and another soft X-ray beam line we are planning, because if you see the whole all the details of the beam lines available on Indus 2, you will find out that this energy range is missing. So that's why we are planning in future the this 1500 EV to 4000 EV beam. So this is the station which we are planning to go for this thing with low temperature attachment for the XMCD. And then these are the basically the another beam line which we are planning in near future for this soft X-ray range, which is not available right now from the Indus 1 and Indus 2. So this energy range will be very effective to assess the L2-3 edges of 4D element, as well as M edges of all rare earth elements containing 4F, 5D, 5F, 6D electron, which are responsible for magnetism in the respective element. At present, this energy range is not accessible on any existing beam line of Indus 2. So this is very important range to probe the electronic and magnetic properties of heavy elements. So already Director Arakad has approved our BL-26 port for on this Indus 2 for this development. So very soon we will complete this development as soon as the funding is available for this. So thank you. So I will conclude my talk that at Indus complex there is a huge possibility for a condensed matter physicist to characterize material bulk as well as thin films nanostructure for their structural, magnetic, electronic properties, as well as to do the chemical analysis. So acknowledging all the technical and supporting staff from the UGC DSAR, Dr. Rahini Zaudari and Mukul Gupta are working with me on this Indus 1 and Indus 2 business. And then I'm thankful to Dr. Siriguri, Director CSR Indo, and the users of Beamline on Indus 1 and Indus 2, as well as the Indus operating staff office. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Fase, for such an elaborate and very interesting talk. I'm sure this will be very useful for the students, particularly who will be interested in using the Indus facilities. I have two quick questions from the users. One is that does Indus 2 has resonant photoemission spectroscopy?
Indus 2 has, yes, resonant photoemission spectroscopy by RRCAT people there.
Okay, but it is available there.
Yeah, and, it is available.
Okay.
And we are also planning, because actually there are a lot of load on our X-ray absorption beam line. There also one can put one station, because in foreign synchrotron you will see that there are different practices that one can change the station also. So in our beam line also one can do that type of, but since X-ray absorption is a very popular technique and the energy range is which is not available in the country. So that's why a lot of people are coming. So that's why we are not putting the photo emission. Otherwise our plan was there to put the photoemissions, a photoelectron spectroscopy station there itself on our X-ray beam line. So there also one can do the resonant photoemission spectroscopy. That we will think once we buy the new station for our BL1. So we can shift the old station there, and then there we can do the or we can plan the new station itself on the BL one on Indus 2.
Okay. One more question from the participant is that can we study the plasmonic properties of various shapes of plasmonic nanoparticles?
Yes.
Okay. That's possible. Okay, and I have one or two questions regarding this. One is that you told about the high pressure XRD which is available on Indus 2. What is the maximum pressure the high pressure can experiments can be done, and is it temperature dependent?
Actually, you can go see the slide. Dr. Pandey is the in charge for that team from BRC.
Okay.
You can contact that him and that details he will tell you about that high pressure cell. And also, AK Sinha is also there for the angle dispersive beamline. There, high pressure is also possible. So both, you can contact me or you can contact the people directly there. And right now, I don't have the numbers of that.
Okay. And for this XRF measurements, what is the difference in terms of resolution when you come or sensitivity when you compare with lab source XRF and the synchrotron XRF?
Basically, you can have the very high resolution there in the synchrotron version. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, sensitivity is very small. Okay. And the time required is also very small, experimental time.
Okay. And for XMCD, what types of samples are required? It is only films or we can use polycrystalline bulk samples?
Yeah, polycrystalline bulk samples are also possible. Basically, we are measuring in the TUI mode. We also have the fluorescent detector, but we have not tested yet the fluorescent detector.
Okay. Yeah. That is all from me. Dr. Simalti, you have some questions? Dr. Siriguri, you want to have ask some questions?
Sir, Siriguri, sir.
Very good talk. And elaborate and sure it would have been very useful for all the participants.
Dr. Simalti, please, you can take
it. Yes. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, Fasi sir. I was mentioning in the beginning of the today's lecture itself that my first interaction with the UGC DAE CSR was with Director Sir Dr. Fasse. I think the Fasse Sir was not, might not recall. In 2003, when we were in postgrad, we came to Indore Center for the first time for the SEM analysis. So the journey of the association with the UGC DACSR began and did that time, 2003, and we got our first paper after finishing our all the work. We got the very first work out of sir support itself. So sir, शायद मौका न मिल पाया और धन्यवाद कहने का तो पहली बार सर से धन्यवाद कहना चाहूँगा. इंदौर सेंटर का स्पेशली हमें बहुत सहयोग मिला है हमारे. आई थिंक आई अक्नॉलेज इंदौर सेंटर फॉर वैरायटी ऑफ सर्विसेज प्रोवाइडेड स्पेशली इवन दो वी वर एलियन फॉर द फिजिसिस्ट पीपल बींग द इन द बायोमेडिकल. We got more than two dozens of paper in that too in very good impact, and we have duly acknowledged UGC DACSR Indore Center for the kind support. I remember Professor Gupta, I remember Professor Dr. Ram. Obviously, your support was vital, and Dr. Sinha. Recently, we are working with Dr. Mukul Gupta also, and Dr. Rajiv Rawat. So I would like to, you know, and especially the DSC team there, we have been very frequent in using the thing of the using the resources, and you people have been very, very cooperative for giving the support with respect to the each and every problem. Rather, you have been the troubleshooter beyond our expectations in many of our experiments. Thank you, sir. Thanks for the UGC DACSR for extending the support to the academic researchers. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sudhin, sir.
So we have.
I'm taking you live. Just hold on.
Okay. So I think we have come to the end of the second day's deliberations, and today I think everything went on smoothly without any technical glitches, so thanks to that. And hopefully tomorrow morning also we will start around 10 o'clock on time with two more lectures on two new facilities which are available at Kolkata and Kalpakka. And so we'll meet tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock and we'll continue with our talks and our workshop for tomorrow. So Dr. Simalti, please can you conclude?
Yes, the link has already been given to all the participants in advance for the tomorrow's lecture and also for the day after tomorrow's lecture. So please be on time and we'll be with you so far. So goodbye for today and we'll see you tomorrow. Thank you, sir. Thank you, UGC DACSR team.
Thank you very much.
So I would like to end the session. Please allow me. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay.